ESPN, the world's leader in motorsports coverage, welcomes you live to Bristol Raceway in Tennessee for the Goodies 500 NASCAR Winston Cup Race. And once again, over 70,000 screaming wild race fans have squeezed into this half-mile facility to see the best in short track racing. It rained earlier this evening here at Bristol. However, the skies have cleared and a beautiful sunset is occurring here as the sun goes down over the mountains of Northeast Tennessee. This is the first race in the second half of the short track season. The quest for the Cup standings, Dale Earnhardt up 79 over Ernie Irvin. Mark Martin is back to third, but by just 7 over Rusty Wallace. Ken Schrader is 74 behind Rusty. Ricky Rudd leads the second 5, but only 296 points separate 6 through 10. Hi, everyone. I'm Bob Jenkins. Welcome to our annual gathering under the lights here at Bristol, where the banks are at 36 degrees and there's trouble lurking behind every corner. I guarantee you, in the next 3.5 hours, we're going to squeeze in some exciting stock car racing for you here tonight. And I also guarantee you that in the next couple of minutes or so, squeezing as much information as possible, are two pit reporters, John Kernan and Dr. Jerry Punch.
Thanks, Bob, and hello, everyone. Now, 5 of the top 10 qualifiers are on Hoosier tires, including the entire front row. Jeff Bodine outside row 1, and our pole sitter, 54-year-old Harry Gant, making his final visit to Bristol International Raceway. But here's the question mark. How long will the Hoosier tires last? Many of these drivers believe that maybe 80 laps would be a push.
Kenny Wallace has been named to sub for Ernie Irvin while he's on the mend. Kenny doing a great job, qualified 15th, but this morning in practice a little bit of a problem, backed it into the wall. But as you can see, the crew has fixed the car and they say it's running almost as good as new.
Rusty Wallace brings his strongest mount to Bristol, Tennessee. This is Midnight beside me. 8 out of 10 wins last year, this race car. Already won in 1994 at Rockingham and Dover. Rusty poised to pick up his 5th career win at Bristol International Raceway.
Dale Earnhardt is the points leader, but he's starting 14th on the grid tonight. That means he's basically in the middle of the pack. We've seen a lot of things happen very quickly at this racetrack. If he's going to maintain that points lead, he has to be cautious tonight.
If there's an emotional edge to any driver in the field, it belongs to one man, Mark Martin, sitting here in the Valvoline Ford. His best friend, Ernie Irvin, now beginning to recover. So Mark Martin wants to dedicate one win to Ernie. That win could come here tonight. By the way, he's a defending champion of the Goodies 500.
Well, for the second weekend in a row, John Andretti is back in the STP Pontiac, doing a great job last week at Michigan. But next week at Darlington, that's still a question mark. The team will get together on Monday and decide who to put in the car next Sunday.
A little trouble in qualifying for a couple of drivers at the back of the pack taking provisionals. We might mention Lake Speed is back there. And Todd Bodine, who had a problem with the steering box on Friday in qualifying, wrecked that car, went to a backup car. Also back there, the car number 22, Bobby Labonte, who qualified toward the front of the field, but wrecked his primary car in the final practice session. And we have to congratulate driver of the car number 10, the Tide Ford, Ricky Rudd, who starts back in 33rd spot. Ricky and Linda had an 8-pound, 3-ounce baby boy at 10.02 p.m. last night. Landon Lee Rudd was born. Ricky is back in the race car after just 3.5 hours sleep from Friday morning.
Well, guys, that was a lot of information to get in a relatively short period of time, but the cars would have made about 8 laps around here while they were doing that, Benny. So when they give those pit reports a little later on, they're going to have to do them quicker.
I tell you, folks, it's unbelievable. This is a half-mile racetrack, but they travel speeds up 135 miles per hour. The bank, 36 degrees, the corners are. These cars get around this racetrack unbelievably fast, around 15 seconds a lap.
Now, they haven't had any practice at night here at Bristol. Of course, this race is at night. All their practice and qualifying was in the daytime. It's going to be interesting how these cars do shake out once the green flag falls here in a few moments, Bob.
Gentlemen, the command has been given. The cars are warming up on pit road, and in just a few moments, they'll go onto the racetrack for a couple of warm-up laps. And then we'll be underway with 500 of the most grueling laps in all of racing. Stay with us. International Raceway as the helihead getting set to bring you all the action. It's a 0.533 mile oval. The front stretch and the back stretch are each 650 feet in length. The corners banked at 36 degrees and the straightaways are banked at 16 degrees. Now, how about the race analysis?
will go 500 laps. The pole speed is 124.186. That's 15.4 seconds. The race record is 101.074. The pit window anywhere between 145 and 155 laps, provided, of course, there are no yellows in that period. And they're racing for a purse of over $800,000.
And already the 22 car, Bobby Labonte, having some problems. The hood is up on that car. He crashed that car in practice this afternoon. This is a backup car. He has not had a lap on this car. Evidently, got some type of problem already.
Let's take a look now at the starting lineup for tonight's race. On the pole is Harry Gant, his third career pole at Bristol in 31 races at 124.186, a new event record. Harry, of course, in his final year of competition. Jeff Bodine will start outside the front row in the Exide Batteries Ford car number 7. In the second row, it'll be Terry Labonte in the car number 5, Kellogg Chevrolet. Outside the second row from St. Louis, Missouri, in the Miller Genuine Draft Ford car number 2 will be Rusty Wallace. And as we take a look at the rest of the starting lineup, gentlemen, there are 8 drivers that are on Hoosier tires tonight, and all of them have qualified in the top 20.
And I tell you what, right now the crew chiefs are telling the drivers, look, this is Bristol. You got to be patient. Be patient. Now, about 20 laps, when they get hung behind someone and can't get by them, the crew chief is going to say, pass that guy, pass that guy. So what do you do? Be patient. That's what you need to be.
Kenny Wallace will start inside row number 8. He won the Busch Grand National race here at Bristol last night, substituting for the injured Ernie Irvin. Jerry, what's the story on the 22 car?
We told you they went to a backup car. Apparently, when they pulled the backup car, they had to change the steering box, and they forgot to fill the steering box with fluid. They had to rapidly fill that steering box. It'd be tough to turn this track with no fluid in the steering box. He wouldn't turn for long, that's for sure, but they were able to fill it, and we're set for green flag racing.
They'll go at least one more lap. Ned, we hear so much about pitting on the backstretch. There are 18 pit positions here on the front stretch. Is it as much of a factor now as it was a couple of years ago?
Not as much now, Bob, because what they're doing is speeding up the pace car after it drops off the cars on the front stretch so the others can get, those who are pitting on the back, get to their pits quicker. So it's not as big a factor as it used to be. Still a disadvantage, though.
Take a look at the list of drivers who have gone home unable to qualify fast enough to make this field. They include Jimmy Spencer, Jeff Green, Dave Marcus. Phil Parsons was unable to make it, driving the number 14 car, Billy Hagan. In cars carried by Lake Speed, he'll be at the back of the pack. There's the roof cam on Jeremy Mayfield's car and the roof cam on Morgan Shepherd. More moving to the front of the grid, there's the roof cam on Ted Musgrave's car and on Mark Martin. And the green flag is out. We are racing in the Goodies 500 at Bristol.
Getting up to speed in the Miller Genuine Draft Ford. And Mark Martin got home on the outside. How many spots did he lose?
Well, he must have lost about 8 or 10 spots. He got up there and couldn't get down on the low groove. That's where everybody wants to be in the early part of this race. But he finally did get in line, back in about 15th position.
A couple of cars are still caught on the outside, but for the most part, it is a single file formation around the racetrack.
There was a little bit of contact between Brett Bodine and Hut Strickland. Brett Bodine in the green 26, Hut Strickland in the 23 car.
Musgrave is kind of caught on the outside.
Yep, he's the only one right now that's caught up on the outside. Morgan Shepherd about to go under him. And Sterling Marlin is right behind Morgan. He'll try to make that pass as well. So Ted Musgrave and his spotter working together, trying to get him to the low side of the track.
We'll be back now from Morgan Shepherd's car onto Sterling Marlin and Ted Musgrave.
Now every car in the field is in single file.
This is the TCI roof cam on Ted Musgrave's Family Channel 4.
Ward Burton has just moved around. Joe Nemechek has taken over the fourth position.
Harry Gant is the leader of the race, and he has led the first seven laps, and that means that he has led more laps tonight than he has led all season. He had only led six coming into this event, and only twice at Pocono and the Brickyard 400 in Indianapolis. Jeff Bodine is second, and Terry Labonte is third.
Really nice to see Harry Gant, Leo Jackson, Charlie Presley, all those guys back and running well.
We've had so many storybook stories during the year this year. Of course, Jeff Gordon's win at Indianapolis. Wouldn't it be nice to see Harry Gant win a race in his?
Oh, the 12th part, Derek Cope, heavy contact with the outside retaining wall coming off the second corner. But he maintains speed. High in the world.
And no caution.
And Kyle Petty got hung up on the outside, almost hit the wall, all four. Folks, we're just telling you about things you can't see, but they're happening all around the racetrack.
Jeff Bodine now right on the rear spoiler of Harry Gantz, number 33, Skoal Bandit. All right, here's the replay now. Watch as the cars come out of the second corner onto the backstretch. Oh, contact there by Derek Cope.
And the straight arrow of Bobby Allison Ford. And that jammed car's up back behind him. There he is. The back end gets loose, clips the wall, then back with the front end into the wall.
I'll tell you one thing. I bet that car doesn't handle too well right now. Wow.
The nine still chasing Gant. Very eligible for $7,600 in Unical bonus money. Of course, it was won weekend by brother Jeff Bodine, who's running second here to Harry.
And Paul Andrews, the crew chief on the Exide battery car, telling Jeff Bodine, patient, now be patient. You're okay. But obviously, every race car driver wants to lead. They want to be out front.
Harry's closing in on some slower traffic. The first that he will lap is the 52 car, Brad Teague.
I've never seen Brad Teague in Jimmy Amin's car.
Napa Auto Parts, your sponsor on the car this week.
And second corners to get around him. And the 40 car is going the wrong way.
He's on the outside. That's Bobby Hamilton, the Kendall Oil car. There's the camera on top of Gordon Chipper Citgo Ford.
Morgan's running 18th. Just ahead of him is Jeff Burton, Rookie of the Year contender.
Shepard started 21st, so he has picked up three positions.
And there are the first two, Harry Gant and Jeff Bodine, as they come up on another slow car. That is Lake Speed, who had to take a provisional to get into the starting lineup. So now there are two cars that have been lapped here in the first 19 laps of this 500-lap affair at Bristol. Terry Labonte is still running in third position, then Ward Burton, the 41 car of Joe Nemechek. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Bristol Raceway in Tennessee and the Goodies 500 NASCAR Winston Cup race being led by Harry Gant at number 33 over Jeff Bodine in number 7. Now we back up to a few laps ago and take a look again.
At a spin coming up turn 4.
It's Mike Wallace.
Traffic bearing down on him, but the spotters are doing their job, telling their drivers where the accident is, and there's proof that things happen fast. We were about to show you a replay of what happened a few laps ago, but interrupted it to bring you the live action. And that first caution comes out on lap 28, and he can't get that car rolling again.
Well, you can see that the wheel is flat. The rim is spinning, but there's no tire there. So I guess he's going to have to get the wrecker out to get it to the fifth. See the right rear tire spinning? Watch that rim.
Spinning at the tire.
Wow. That break from Mike Wallace. He and Kyle Petty made some contact coming off turn 4. This is right in front of the leaders. It's going to happen. There we see the Kyle Petty right behind Mike Wallace. They made a little bit of contact. And around goes Mike. and really truly doesn't hit the wall that hard. It's just as he locked the brakes down, you can see the tires blowing. As he stops the tire, it goes across that concrete and just grinds a hole in the tire.
And there's the bump that Kyle Petty gave to Mike Wallace.
Yep, and it just sent him spinning around. Kyle had a pretty good run coming off of that turn, ran up on him and bumped him. Let's go to the pits and Jerry Punch.
And guys, about two laps before that happened, actually, Mike Wallace and Todd Bodine, the 90 car and the 75 car, running side by side. And Kyle came upon him in turn one and had nowhere to go and jammed on the brakes and nearly spun his own car out. He managed to hang on to the car, trying to get by these two cars. So there had been a battle raging there for about three laps.
The 40 car of Bobby Hamilton that we told you was going backwards anyway, losing positions, is in and now going back out. And the 42 car is in.
And he stopped at the end of pit road. I don't know. I guess they're waiting for the field to go by.
We assume so.
He must be lapped. He would not be in that position then. Let's find out.
Well, Petty goes back out onto the racetrack, as does Lake Speed, who came in for a brief stop. We're under caution for the first time here in Bristol. Back with more in a moment. ESPN helicopter camera shots being brought to you by Steel, makers of a full line of outdoor power equipment, powerful, easy to use, and durable. Thanks for the overhead shots of Bristol Raceway. Now, we've been talking about the squeeze, and again, it has occurred very quickly. This is looking back from Morgan Shepherd onto Sterling Marlin. And our most recent incident occurred in turn four when Kyle Petty and Mike Wallace got together.
And around goes Mike and had a couple of flat tires. We're back green flag racing. And Kyle Petty has been in the pits, changed some tires. He's a lap down. He's trying to get a lap back. John, why did he get lapped?
Petty, because he was near the tail end of the field. When he came into pits, they didn't have time to change four tires. Kyle was telling him over the radio, just go right sides only. But they had already taken the left side lug nuts off. So he had to sit there and wait until they got the left side lug nuts back on. He wound up losing the lap anyway, but right now he is on the tail end because he's gotten around here again.
And something's wrong with John Andretti as he's right down off the banking.
Right rear tire is flat. The right rear tire is flat on the STP Pontiac. Tough break for Andretti.
Young man who is trying to find a full-time ride. There you can see that it went down on the backstretch, and he just got the car out of the groove and let everybody go around.
They did a great job of getting out of the way and maintaining control of the STP Pontiac.
So John Andretti gets new rubber. John, are you there?
Yeah, Bob, he's only taking right side tires only. I'm looking at that right rear tire. I don't see a puncture mark, but you can see the rear bumper that someone had run into the back of John Andretti.
He's lost two laps as the battle up front continues between Harry Gant and Jeff Bodine. You can see both of them have put Kyle Petty a lap down again. Terry Labonte still running third, then Joe Nemechek and Rusty Wallace. Understand that the 23 car of Hut Strickland has been in the pits.
He's still going. He made a pit stop during that caution, so he was back near the tail end of the pack. He's still in the lead lap, but he's slowing down. He might be headed into the pits.
Here comes a big group of cars being led by Dick Frickle. There's Jeff Gordon, Lake Speed, Rick Mast, Bill Elliott, Nemechek. Nemechek was running in fourth position, however, has fallen back to 10th.
There's a camera on top of Lake Speed's fourth quality pit car. See Earnhardt back there on the inside of Nemechek taking that spot away. Earnhardt's back in about 10th spot now.
12th, they're showing him, Benny.
Let's look at the telemetry on Mark Martin's car to see exactly how fast he does.
Well, it won't be quite as fast because he's on the outside trying to lap Lake Speed, so he won't go quite as fast here as he would there. He has cleared him. Earnhardt coming up now. Martin now being shown in 10th, Earnhardt up to 11th.
That's Darrell Waltrip, the winningest active driver here at Bristol, behind the 17 car.
And we see Hutch Strickland, the smoking joke
car down on the apron of the racetrack as the leaders went by.
Yeah, he has been in the pits, Benny. Whatever damage he did when he clipped the wall there a moment ago, I guess he went in to get that repaired. It was reported this week that Hutt will be leaving that team at the end of this year, so Travis Carter will be naming someone else to drive the Smokey Joe's car.
Between Trickle in the 32 and Jeff Gordon.
Put that for sixth spot.
Trickle had himself a great qualifying run here. What a short track specialist he really is.
And right in front of him, Rusty Wallace. Ward Burton is blown going down the front straightaway. We see the smoke coming out of the Hardy's Chevrolet.
That's it. And the 43 car, John Andretti's in the wall.
Andretti between turns 3 and 4, right up against the outer wall. Here's John Kernan.
Well, Neil, this is the right rear tire that came off of John Andretti's car earlier, and you can see he got together with the yellow car out there. They knocked the valve stem out. That's why this tire went flat.
And now he has even bigger problems because he has damaged the rear end of that car immensely and is finally off the racetrack. But John Andretti is having a tough time here in the early going.
There's a lot of damage to that car, and unfortunately, that's where they put the fuel in the car back to the left rear. So you see where he's dragging. He's going to have a lot of trouble filling the car up with gasoline.
There's Ward Burton's Hardy's Chevrolet. He was smoking. And whether he put anything down on the racetrack in the oil, I don't know.
He was up as high as what, fourth then, I believe?
Yes.
And the 16 car, Ted Musgrave, is also in for a pit stop. And there's King Richard directing John to go behind the wall so they can take a look at that car and see if they can't get it back in the race. Here's the Rick Mass car that's in for a stop. Joe Nemechek is also in.
Those drivers are on the Hoosier tires, so they've run about 49. They're on their 50th lap right now, so I guess they wanted to come in and get those tires off, see how they're looking. Ted Musgrave was in. Of course, he's going back out, and they're under the hood of the Hardy's Chevrolet.
A little bit more serious situation for both Ward Burton and John Andretti, who caused our second caution of the evening. Back in a moment. We welcome you to Bristol Raceway in Tennessee for the Goodies 500, the 22nd race of the 31-race NASCAR Winston Cup season. And Ward Burton is having problems. Here's Jerry Punch.
Well, Bobby qualified seventh and came toward the front in a hurry. Ward, you were coming in a hurry. What happened?
I really don't know, Chuck, but Hardy's car's running great. Tires are doing good again. We just can't last long enough. One day we're going to get this thing all together, though.
Was it a valve ward or something else in the engine?
It acted just like it did at Michigan last week. I think it did drop a valve.
Well, a puff of smoke. He started seventh, had just passed the Terry Labonte car to take the third spot when suddenly it came apart.
Bob? All right, Jerry, so Ward will watch from the sidelines, at least for the moment, as we get set to go back to racing on lap number 54. The pace car is in, the crowd rises and cheers, the green flag as it waves, and Harry Gant leads him down to resume racing. Bobby Labonte has positioned himself between Gant and Jeff Bodine.
Boy, Harry Gant's loving this, isn't he? Put some distance on Bodine while Bobby Labonte is in the middle of these cars.
Jeff Bodine, his best finish here at Bristol was a third, and he's done that on four different occasions. Here's Mark Martin, Bill Elliott, and Dale Earnhardt as they run back in seventh, eighth, and ninth.
And right behind these guys is Darrell Walter, who started 16th. He has the Western Auto Chevrolet on the move. There goes DW.
12 times he has taken the checkered flag here at Bristol. 5 times in the April race and 7 times in this one. The most recent was in 1992. His first win here was in 1978.
Oh!
And a crash involving Terry Labonte into the wall hard in turn 4.
Man, that car was running so good. The Kellogg's cornflake car was flying. We see a little fire under the car.
Terry Labonte wanting, among other things, to move into the top 10 in points. He's 12th going into this race, but didn't catch a break tonight as the yellow comes out for the third time as his car is against the wall in the fourth turn.
It is a tough break for Terry. Now he waited for the traffic to clear. He rolls the car down off the track, but I'm sure they've got some work to do on him on that Chevrolet before he can get back out there.
And Jeff Bodine comes in the pits right behind him, so Bodine gives up his second place to get those Hoosier tires looked at.
I'll tell you what, that really surprised me that Jeff would pit this early because of the track position.
Unusual, perhaps. Jerry, all fours down there?
Exactly, Bob. All four tires. It would be unusual. Most people could go to lap 140 to 150 on fuel, but you got to remember, Jeff Bodine and Harry Gant, a lot of concern about how these Hoosiers are going to wear. They're going to be fast, but what about the wear of the car? So they're also looking at the front of the car. Apparently, some indention on the hood of the car. They were trying to get the hood bowed back down because you can't get the front of the car clogged up. The car will definitely overheat here in Bristol.
I see he's made contact with someone and knocked the hood down the car, and they're concerned about the car overheating.
Here's a replay of the incident involving Terry Labonte. Couldn't see whether he got help.
Well, the Lake Speed looked like the next car directly behind him, and whether or not there was any help there, we don't know.
See the car scrambling down on the flat part of the racetrack. Here's Rusty Wallace's view.
It was contact between the 15 and the 5.
So we're under our third caution. Jerry, you have more on this?
Paul Andrews told me that when they hit the back of Harry Gant at the first caution flag, when it came out, the 7 car said the hood was crumpled in, and now we're beginning to show a little bit of water temperature. So, hey, we got a great car, but we don't want to cook it early.
Okay, that's the reason that Jeff Bodine came in, that and to get all four tires replaced. The lead continues to be held by Harry Gant. Now, here it is from Lake Speed's vantage point.
Boy, it didn't take much of a bump there to send him spinning because it was in the turn, and you're almost out of control when you're in the turn anyway, and just that slight bump by Lake Speed spent Terry around.
61 laps have been completed here at Bristol. Rusty Wallace has now moved to second. We'll be right back. We have resumed racing after our most recent caution, which was out for 5 laps. As you can see, Kyle Petty had his lap back, but now loses it to Harry Gant once again.
Good start, jumped on the inside of Harry and got back out in front, and now Harry is passing back, so Kyle goes a lap down. There are 26 cars in the lead lap.
Rusty Wallace and Jeff Gordon are running second and third. They, too, have gotten around Petty. There's Rusty Wallace, who is a 4-time winner here at Bristol, but he has never won this race. All 4 of his victories have come in the spring event.
See that Harry Gant, once he got in front of Kyle Petty, just pulls away.
The 40 car of Bobby Hamilton, which had problems early, apparently has gotten them solved, Ned.
Yeah, he made a pit stop here, not this last caution, Bob, but the one before, put new tires on it, made some adjustments, and he has really been coming back up through the field since then.
And Jeff Gordon has taken second from Rusty Wallace. You can see how quickly things happen and how quickly we have to make our camera cuts to show you all the action. But Jeff is ahead of Rusty now.
And there you see this pack of cars going by Lake Speed. And there were a lot of cars taking advantage. Bill Elliott was passed by a couple of cars, by Earnhardt and Darrell Waltrip, as he tried to get alongside the 15 car. Also, Bobby Hamilton was able to get by.
Might update you on the tire situation. The report from those taken off of Jeff Bodine's car was that they're showing pretty good wear, and the others should be able to run 40 or 50 more laps on the set they have on the car.
That's a report from one of the Hoosier representatives. Said they looked at the tires and said they should get another, you say, 40 or 50 laps with no problem.
On top of Morgan Shepherd's Citgo 4, that's Craig Sachs, Justin Hill in the U.S. Air Car. you can gain positions quickly and you can also lose them. Look at this. Wallace just slightly out of the groove, and Jeff Gordon and Kyle Petty pass by on the bottom side of the racetrack.
Yeah, there's usually someone to fill a hole if the one opens up.
Here is Morgan Shepherd working on Greg Sachs.
19 Fords, 12 Chevrolets, 5 Pontiacs, 28 of the cars. Oh, my goodness. 20 of the cars started on Goodyear. And what was that, 8 on Hoosier? I thought they had made some contact.
And there goes Morgan around the 77. And now here comes Kenny Wallace in the 28, substituting for Ernie Irvin. That puts Morgan in the 10th position.
So Mark was able to get by Trickle in the last few laps. Now Earnhardt's up there trying to do the same thing.
We're taking a look at the inside of Dick Trickle. Dale Earnhardt, 31 career races here at Bristol and 8 wins, including the spring race here. And in case you've forgotten, he came from 24th starting position in April to win. Just all over Trickle.
That's a camera shot from our robotic camera.
Let's go back and check out some more action behind that group of cars.
Well, there has been some heavy racing here at Ricky Rudd. Bunch of cars have really been going at it.
Now they've got Sachs hung on the outside, and all these cars are going to try to get by.
Yeah, they'll look for that opening down on the inside, and he's going to have a tough time getting that down the inside green. General Bodine comes by now. Brett Bodine.
They also have got the 12 car hung out there. That's Derek Cope. There goes Musgrave by. Now Schrader wants to go along as well. And there's Mike Wallace. We see he's got the flask repaired on his car back on the racetrack.
There's Derek Cope in the 12 car. He had an early contact with the wall that didn't bring out a caution. And look where the leader is. He is right behind that group of cars and putting a lap, another lap, on Teague.
Boy, Dan, there's some heavy traffic right there that he's got to weave his way through. About a 10 car length lead over Jeff Gordon. Now Sachs moves down out of the way, gives him running room. So they single out in front of him. So that makes the job a lot easier.
Earnhardt looked like he might have gotten the back of the 32 car. Trickle goes up the hill. Earnhardt goes by. Darrell Walters follows it.
And while that was going on, Mark Martin went by Rusty Wallace.
The back stretch and into three. Boom.
Hello.
Out of my way.
Runs up and gives him a little tap. Trickle has no choice but to back off, and so two cars go by.
Dale Earnhardt moves to fifth position. There is Darrell Walters in sixth. But that's how much of a separation there is between that group and Harry Gant, the leader. Jeff Gordon is coming right up on Harry, though.
I don't know if it's the traffic that's slowing Harry down or if Jeff Gordon's picking up or Harry Gant's slowing down. But you can see, obviously, he's closing up.
Yes, he is closing up in a hurry. Look at him going into the turns faster. Wonder if Gant's tires might be getting worn. Something we were concerned. He moved down to the inside. Let's Gordon go.
Yeah, he sure did, Jeff. Saw the opportunity that Harry gave him and took the lead.
That's exactly what we saw last night, Ned. Remember, Harry Gant ran so well, but then all of a sudden the car just started slowing down.
And so Harry Gant led the first 88 laps of this event, and now Jeff Gordon has gone to the front. Behind Harry Gant, running in third position, is Mark Martin. Back with more from Bristol International Raceway in a moment. A beautiful setting in the hills of Northeast Tennessee, Bristol Raceway. They're the top 15 as we have completed 95 of 500 laps. And you will notice in second and third position, there was a change. When we went to break, Mark Martin was in third, Gant was second. Well, they have changed positions, and this is how Mark Martin did it.
Comes off the corner. He tries to get alongside Harry Gant down the back straightaway. Harry realizes these cars are much faster than he is, so he just pulls over and lets Mark Martin go by.
Harry told us on our live Speed Week show that he had a little bit of concern about those tires. Jerry, what is the situation with Harry Gant?
Well, that's exactly what Harry was talking about in Speed Week. When the tires begin to fall off, there's no need in trying to push the car and make it up, or else you're going to be in the wall. So he tried to, Charlie Preston, the crew chief, told Harry, back off. Let's try to make it a full fuel stop and fit when the other Goodyear cars fit. Let us take a look and see how the tires look. One car already on pit road. That's Kenny Schrader. Let's check in with John Kernan.
Schrader thinks Marty had a right front tire going down, so he decided to pit for two tires, right side rubber only. Also, the car now is going to come around and will now be a four-tire change. They're also planning to make a chassis adjustment, try and loosen the car up. The car has been very, very tight. Kenny Schrader making his pit stop. He's down and away.
Just lost a lap. He'd just been lapped, had he, Ned?
He had, and now he has two laps down.
And he comes out and nearly collides with the 22 of Bobby Labonte, which is coming into the front stretch pits.
Yeah, that was a close call for both of them.
And Labonte has been in and out of the pits all night long.
He's had a tough time here tonight so far. He's being shown now. It's about 28 laps down.
Jeff Gordon has just lapped Jeff Burton, who is running 25th. Here's more on Jeff Burton.
Actually, Bob was talking about Bobby Labonte, and we told you he went to a backup car. That's the car they run in Atlanta. He's been on pit road twice for a tire rubbing the fender. They came in and changed the track bar once. They added weight in the car as far as trying to get more wedge in it. It just changed everything on the race car except the number in the last 25 or 30 laps.
There's our leader, Jeff Gordon. Mark Martin's in second. Rusty Wallace has now moved into third, and Dale Earnhardt fourth. Darrell Waltrip is now fifth.
21 cars are on the lead lap.
And we see Harry Gant losing the spot to Bill Elliott as they go down in the corner.
Well, Harry's just hoping for a caution flag here before too long.
And there is Gordon, who is leading his 12th race of 1994. Two victories, Charlotte and Indianapolis. He started in 12th position, and of course, he is the highest he has been, and he has led the last 15 laps.
And he's right behind a bunch of heavy traffic. See Rusty Wallace and Dale Earnhardt
as they battle for third position. And the point squeeze comes to mind here as Rusty tries to catch Dale for that NASCAR Winston Cup Championship. That's for Rusty's car looking back on Dale.
Car spins all around right in front of Wallace and Earnhardt. He makes a 360, keeps going.
Caution is out. Amazing how quickly these drivers have to react, and most of them are able to. Here comes Jeff.
Here's now Musgrave trying to beat him back to the line.
Maybe Jeff Burton might have gotten.
Yeah, that was close, but I think maybe he did. The 77 car of Greg Sachs got one of his two laps back.
There's our second place car, Mark Martin. Now I think we'll be seeing all the cars pit, don't you, Ned?
Oh, I don't think there's any question. Yes, they'll be coming in.
Tough break for Kenny Schrader. He made a pit stop, changed four tires. Now these guys get to do it for free.
Grissom had just made a pit stop about five laps ago, and here come the leaders down pit road right now.
Being led by Jeff Gordon, Mark Martin is behind. Here comes Rusty, Dale, Darrell, Trickle, Elliott, Mast, Gant. Here's Jerry Funk.
As you watch all the leaders pit here on the front stretch, I will remind you, this is a big break for Harry Gant. They were going to pit him next lap by when the caution came out. A big break for Gant. He would have pitted under green and lost at least two laps. The front runner getting four tires. Jeff Gordon, the first one off the jacks. He is down pit road at 35 miles an hour. Also out of the pits, Mark Martin. Here's Rusty Wallace. Gordon, Martin, and Wallace. Let's check into the back pits and John Kernan.
Morgan Shepherd is in. Right side tires changed by the Wood Brothers. The car is a little bit tight. As you see, Jeff Gordon, Mark Martin, Rusty Walls, and Dale Earnhardt flash down the backstretch. They will make a chassis adjustment in the left rear on Morgan Shepherd's single board. Now Morgan is finally down in a way that several cars can't fall on the backstretch.
Brent Bodine pulling out just ahead of him.
And we have a replay of the spin involving Lake Speed from his roof cam. And keeps it going. So pit stops continuing on the back stretch, but the field is reassembling for a resumption of action here in the Goodies 500 at Bristol Raceway. Missed one lap of competition as Jeff Gordon continues to lead. He has three top 10 finishes in the last five races, although his two wins have come on super speedways at Charlotte and Indianapolis. Jeff Gordon is no stranger to this type of racing. He cut his teeth, of course, in sprint cars and midgets on tracks like Winchester in Indiana. It's very similar to this.
And Salem, Indiana.
Yep.
Similar racetrack similar to this.
On top of Mark Martin's car, Mark is running second.
And Dale Earnhardt is third. Rusty Wallace is fourth. Dale Jarrett is fifth. Darrell Walker, sixth. Bill Elliott, seventh. Fifth. Bodine is eighth.
You saw that John Andretti has come back into the race. Now a little telemetry.
Did I see 138 miles an hour?
36 of 38, yep.
Let's watch as he accelerates down the front straightaway.
Yep, 138.
138.
Down to a little over 100. Big pack of cars. Lake Speed, Harry Gant, Rick Mast. And they're all passing Lake Speed, including Todd Bodine in 75. There goes Sterling Marlin.
Lake Speed. Lake Speed is being shown four laps down.
Kenny Wallace in the 28 car, the Hadland car.
He's 15th, Benny.
You know, Kenny Wallace is not trying to be a hero. He just simply wants to bring this car home with a good finish today.
Mark Martin is about to pass Jeff Gordon. He does it.
Hey, we have the third leader of the afternoon.
Gordon slipped just a little bit coming off turn two. Martin had a good run on him and just moved right on by.
I think someone said Mark Martin is the defending champion of this race.
That was part of his four in a row last year, and this is the 14th race that Mark has led in 94. Martin Wallace, of course, in a heated battle in the points positions.
You can see Mark's rear, the rear of the car bottom out as he comes off that second corner.
Todd Bodine, Kenny Wallace, Brett Bodine, and Joe Nemechek as they battle for 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th. And the 13th place car is Morgan Shepherd with whom we ride.
There we see the end. The shot down the back straightaway. Todd Bodine was up closer to the front. He had some problem down at turn one a few laps ago. Set up the racetrack. Several cars got by him. Greg Sachs on the outside. And he makes the pass.
Kenny Wallace will try to do that same thing.
Well, we've been talking about tires all night. Let's see how the wear is going. Here's Dr. Punch.
You won't wonder why Harry was slowing when I show you this. Now, the right rear tire was completely worn out. The left front was beginning to wear. But let me show you the left rear. This is the left rear. You see the heat here in the tire? That is where the tire has begun to blister. As I roll the tire along, you see the heat in the inside of the tire is beginning to peel away some of the tread. And Harry Gant, in about three laps, would have been in serious trouble. Bob?
So he did need that caution period to allow him to come in. Look at this action.
These guys split the 77 car going in turn three. Ricky Rudd was able to get by Musgrave. There comes Jeremy Mayfield. The 98 car is the Finger Hut car. That's the camera on top of that automobile.
These cars trying to stay ahead of the leader. Mayfield is already a lap down. Trying to stay on the lead lap. Now here is Darrell Waltrip looking to the inside of Dale Jarrett for fifth place. And Darrell has it.
And one thing to put Jarrett up there in fifth place, he only changed two tires during that pit stop. He's pitting on the back straight, so they only took on two tires. Perhaps hurting him a little bit right now, but it did give him good track position. He's losing some of his position right now. Bill Elliott went by for sixth. Now Jarrett drops back to seventh.
I don't know if it's the overheating problem he's concerned about or what the problem is. There we see Harry again. He's changed four tires. He's back racing again, trying to pass Dale Jarrett for what position? About eighth?
Yep. Harry's trying to make the most of the tires while they're good under him. It looks like he's positioned himself inside of Jarrett, and Harry Gant takes away the seventh spot. Mayfield is not on the same lap as Ricky Rudd and Ted Musgrave. Musgrave and Rudd are running 20th and 21st.
They were just about to go a little. In fact, Ted Musgrave had gone a lap down, but he beat the leader back to the start-finish line during the last caution. He got back in the lead lap, and Rudd was just not far from going a lap down before that last caution.
I'll tell you what, if these guys don't pick up the pace, Ned, they'll have to do the same thing again, because Martin, the leader, is gaining on them considerably. He's in the same straightaway as these two cars.
Earnhardt and Wallace are still going at it for third as another lap is put on Lake Speed.
Lake is now five laps down, back in 28th position.
New uniform of Rusty Wallace, that nice gold uniform.
About that.
I'm sure
it's a lot cooler than that black that he's been wearing.
Yeah. Look at him flex his right arm there. Did you see that? I can't imagine making 2,000 corners on this racetrack. The lead continues to be held by Mark Martin, who after his win a year ago finished 21st in the spring race here at Bristol. Back in a moment. We are under caution for the fifth time this evening. Jeff Bodine came in for a pit stop. Some pit stops also being accomplished on the back stretch. Mike Wallace going out. We're under caution because of a spin involving Hut Strickland.
Going in turn three, I did not see the accident. I saw the aftermath. He backed in the wall with the right rear. We saw John Andretti back in the wall over there with the left rear. This Hut Strickland's damage was to the right rear of the car. There we see the Smoke and Joe car in the back pits.
They got the hood up. So that's going to be in for a while as damage is repaired on that car. And Jerry has a report on the pit stop that was made by Jeff Bodine.
On the previous caution on lap 110, Bodine came in and only took two tires on the right side. Now, that didn't help the car very much. He went back out, and when the green came out, Benny Parsons noted that Bodine wasn't running that well. Well, the car was so loose, Benny, he couldn't drive it, so he was obligated to come in this time and change all four tires. Hopefully, that'll tighten the car up a little bit for him. He was having trouble keeping the car on the racetrack entering the corner.
Jeff, one of the four drivers, and they have had a very good year so far. Ford has led 4,755 of the 5,973 laps, 80%, while Chevy has led 20%, and Pontiac only 16 laps so far in 94. The manufacturer's standings indicate that Ford is just three races. If they have wins, they could clinch the championship. 168 to 145 is the point standings with Pontiac at 86. Aware of about to go back to green as the crowd is up once again.
And this is an enthusiastic crowd, isn't it?
This is the as good as it gets as far as crowds are concerned.
I think I'll stand up and watch the race myself.
The 22 car of Bobby Labonte continues to have problems, and it is on the front stretch pit as we are within a half lap from going green.
Harry Gant, the pole sitter, also made a pit stop that last time.
By the way, Labonte is 32 laps down. Well, they rise again, Benny. Here we go. Green flag is waving on lap 148. Mark Martin, followed by Jeff Gordon, Dale Earnhardt, Rusty Wallace, and Darrell Waltrip. And now an attempt by Earnhardt to take over second position.
And he does it.
He does.
Jeff Gordon was trying to get by Derek Cope on the outside when he came off the second corner. He got a little bit wide, and Earnhardt ducked under to take over the second spot. And meanwhile, Jeff Burton is trying to get by Mark Martin.
Jeff still trying to get his lap back. He is running 22nd. Drivers have come from a couple of laps down to finish very well here.
And we can see right now with the fresh tires. Heavy traffic all the way around this racetrack.
Poor Ricky Rudd got himself caught on the outside there. Mobile long, lost about five or six positions.
Todd Bodine's running 12th. Started 36th, so another good run after a poor qualifying effort by Todd. He has been up as high as 9th. There are a couple of the Hoosier drivers, Gant and Bodine. They started on the front row and are trying to weave back up through the traffic.
Kenny Wallace got caught on the outside. He's losing positions back there as well. Well, there's a lot of racing going on everywhere. Here's Todd Bodine. Lost the position. Now he's trying to get it back, going on the outside.
Wow. He just drove in on the outside, didn't he?
Yeah, he did.
While we're watching that, a little contact there between Musgrave and Bodine. While we're watching this action, both Jeff Burton and Derek Cope got their laps back. So now 23 cars are on the lead lap. Here's another battle. That's Jeremy Mayfield. Side of Kenny Wallace.
Kenny Wallace is having some problems. He's hung on the outside. I thought once he got back in line, he'd be okay. But once he got back in line, other cars passing. So he is not having as well as he would like, obviously.
He's in 20th position. Kenny Wallace is in the Haviland Ford.
Once again, we see Ricky Rudd hung on the outside.
Rusty Wallace and Darrell Walker. We'll show you another field story. Dale Earnhardt failed to lead a lap at Michigan last weekend for only the 7th time this season.
Oh, we got a spin coming up.
Nobody's hurt real bad. Kenny Wallace was involved.
What happened? Dale Jarrett and Todd Bodine got together coming off of turn 4. Jarrett was on the outside of Bodine. They got together coming off the turn there, and that just jammed everything up behind there.
Kenny Wallace did a 360, kind of like Lake Speed did a little bit ago, and round he went.
Mike Wallace was also in the mix. Let's see who else.
Well, Todd Bodine was actually in front of Dale Jarrett and came back up there. Jarrett hit him a little bit, and then they just jammed up behind. It was sort of a chain reaction type of a deal.
Brett Bodine and Kenny Wallace spun. Gary Punch is in Mark Martin's pit.
And Martin will pit as will Dale Earnhardt further up pit road toward turn one. We expect to see a four-tire change here. Right side tires already coming off. And we'll make a chassis adjustment in the right rear and around and about around to the corner. Gordon is down. He's out of pit road. And here comes Rusty Wallace. He is down. Here is Mark Martin as they dash back to turn one. And it'll be Earnhardt, Wallace, and then Martin. Let's go to the back pits and John Kernan.
Michael Wallace has already changed his tires. Back out on the racetrack, you're looking at Sterling Marlin. He's a four-tire change. Also, he's had some contact out there on the racetrack. The grill was pushed in. They have pulled that out.
Sterling Marlin rolling back on the racetrack. Did Jeff Gordon get two or four tires?
Evidently changed two tires.
He was out awfully quick. Wasn't he?
Joe Mikuchek will be leading the race. Ted Musgrave should be in second place.
I'm going to take a look at this from Morgan Shepherd's car. Whoa.
So it looks like Brett Bodine and Brad T got the worst of that crash because Brett Bodine hit pretty doggone hard.
This is our sixth caution period of the evening.
Kenny Schroeder got some damage as well. We see him trying to pull the bear's head back out where it looks like a...
And there is the damage sustained by Brett Bodine's Quaker State Ford in that most recent incident. Back with more after this. Bob Jenkins, Ned Jarrett, Benny Parson, John Kernan, Dr. Jerry Punch. Back at Bristol Raceway, we were under caution once again. Now, I want you to ponder this for a while. The answer is not Darrell Waltrip. Who holds the best per race average finish among drivers who have started at least 20 events here at Bristol? Think about that for a while, and I'll give you the answer in a moment as we get ready to go back to Green Flag Racing. And up front is Joe Nemechek, leading for the first time in his NASCAR Winston Cup career. By the way, this is the fifth anniversary of Hedrick Racing. They came here 5 years ago tonight in Bristol and began their Winston Cup career with Larry Pearson behind the wheel.
Kyle Petty getting back in the lead lap once again. He has done that several times tonight when others were leading. Let's see if he can stay out in front of Nemechek.
Ed Musgrave is right behind Joe. We're watching from the roof cam.
Dale Jarrett is third. Morgan Shepherd is fourth. Jeff Gordon is fifth. Those first four cars did not make pit stops. They had all stopped during the last caution. So they figured they didn't need a pit stop this time. They didn't like that track position.
Boy, track position is everything here. Look, this is from Ted Musgrave's car. See where he touches the brake going in the corner. Accelerates down the back straightaway, 135 miles an hour.
Down to about 105. And about 8,500 RPM before the brake. Dale Jarrett is right behind, in fact, beside of Ted Musgrave. And Dale Jarrett goes to second.
Started back in 29th position. Ted Musgrave, his car not handling too good right now. There, Rick Sachs comes back by. Look if it's handling or what it is, but he's
Oh my goodness, Dick Trickle almost spun down the front straightaway.
It's as close as you can come to wrecking without.
Rick Strickland comes back out in the Smoking Joe's car as we watch all this action. Dime brothers there. Jeff and Don. A moment ago. There's Strickland out on the inside. Bobby Hamilton has been running up on that outside for a good portion of this race, and his car sticks up there.
Mm-hmm. I'll tell you what, if he could get that groove worked out, he's got a spot on the racetrack that no one else is trying to run there.
Yeah.
Rusty Wallace trying to take a spot away from Michael Waltrip, and he does.
Ooh, and the leader spins in turn one as Joe Nemechek went on the inside of Kyle Petty. Kyle didn't know he was there, I guess. And anyway, they spin. Caution is out.
I don't know know whether Nemechek sustained any damage or not. I think maybe he got by unscathed, but he, of course, lost a lot of track position as Kyle Petty is now back underway also.
Greg Sachs got his lap back during this little deal.
All right, let's look at it again.
Here we go down the front straightaway. Nemechek gets a run off of turn four, moves on the inside of Kyle Petty. Kyle comes down into the groove like he normally would, perhaps didn't know that Nemechek was there. Nemechek hits him, spins him around, and they do a little other touching there, and there's Greg Sachs getting by Dale Jarrett as Jarrett takes the lead, and everybody gets by these two cars and goes on around.
And Jerry Punch is in Joe Nemechek's pit.
Well, Joe Nemechek was just getting ready to maybe take it easy a little bit and try to be easy on those Hoosier tires, but apparently he's going to take it easier than he'd like. He's on pit road now, changing all four tires. The grill completely missing from the front of the car. They may want to put some wire back across that. They will change right side and now left side tires. You see the contact point where he hit Kyle Petty as the entire front grill is missing in front of the radiator, but he is down and away after a four-tire change.
Ted Musgrave pulls out right behind him. Well, let's take a look at the rookie points. And Nemechek is within five of Jeff Burton. Steve Grissom is third in the rookie points. Andretti is fourth, and Mike Wallace is in fifth. Who else is involved in this battle? Ward Burton, Loy Allen, and Jeremy Mayfield with 100.
Tell you what, Joe Nemechek has some problems starting out the year, but the last few races, he has really been up front.
You bet he has. Back with more live from Bristol International Raceway. Welcome back to Bristol. Which driver holds the best per-race average finish among the drivers that have started at least 20 races here at Bristol International? Dan, you want to venture a guess?
Well, you know, I would have thought maybe it'd been Darrell Waltrip, but maybe we go back a little bit further than that to BP.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is Benny Parsons.
You're kidding.
7.583 average finish in 24 starts. Congratulations.
I wish you'd paid more money.
Wow. Jerry Punch is with Terry Labonte.
Well, the driver of the Kellogg Chevrolet sits on top of the pit box, and Terry, not where you wanted to be. They work on the car behind you. How bad is the car hurt?
It's pretty bad. The rear end, the trailing arms, the control arms. It was a shame. Our Kellogg Chevy was running good. Lake Speed, I was trying to get by him. He was up there at the front, several laps down, and I got into the back of him, so I guess he paid me back getting in turn three.
If you see steam coming from the Kellogg's car, that's why. Terry Labonte just jumped out of the car a minute ago and sitting up here trying to cool off in the evening breeze, but he's still quite a bit hot. Bob?
And there's some damage on Mark Martin's left rear. What caused that?
I don't know.
I'd say it's one of these chain reaction deals that we've seen. Somebody jammed the brakes and had to slow down right quick, and somebody else didn't.
And once again, I thought we were going back green flag racing this time, but...
Not yet.
One lap to go.
At 7:50 tomorrow morning, 4:50 a.m. on the West Coast. Join us for the Grand Prix of Belgium Formula One race from Spa. And as you saw during Speed Week earlier this evening, Rubens Barrichello will be on the pole for that race, and Michael Schumacher will start alongside the front row.
I read that he qualified on a wet track with slick tires. Took a chance.
There are the top five qualifiers. Spa, of course, has a history of rainy and foggy weather, so maybe that's the conditions under which they qualified. But anyway, Barrichello on the pole in the Jordan tomorrow for the Grand Prix of Belgium. All right, we're ready now to go back to racing here at Bristol on lap 184. Dale Jarrett has the lead. Jeff Gordon, Dale Earnhardt, Rusty Wallace, and Mark Martin are trailing. Dale Jarrett's 17th race here at Bristol, the fifth race that he has led here, and his best Bristol finish was a second in April of 92.
To the late Alan Kowicki.
Go ahead, man. Outside pole sitter. Ooh, and he and Kenny Schrader get together.
And that sets off again a chain reaction, and everybody gets by all right.
Kyle Petty moving around. Kenny Schrader made that unscheduled pit stop. early, and it's three laps down.
This began way back in the third turn.
Shredder gets down on the apron of the racetrack, and they come back coming off four. They get together again, and we can see Kyle Petty, Sterling Marlin. They all started checking up to avoid the crash.
Dick Trickle way back there almost got into the wall. Boy, it happens quick here.
Jeff Gordon closing in on Jarrett.
Now, Jarrett has about 25 or 30 laps more on his tires than does Gordon. Don't have much of a difference that night. Plus, Jeff Gordon has been fast all night.
Here's another group of cars battling for position. Bobby Hamilton looking to the inside of Ted Musgrave.
That's not your groove. You're supposed to be on the outside.
Like that Pontiac will go just about wherever he wants to put it.
Derek Hope and Brett Bodine also racing with Musgrave and Hamilton. Here's Jeff Bodine going inside of Darrell Waltrip and picking up sixth position.
About Jeff Bodine earlier in the race about 75 laps ago. I think I don't have to worry anymore. The car is running back, running well.
Rusty Wallace and Mark Martin are running fourth and fifth.
And Rusty Wallace was struggling with his car at the beginning of the race, but on that first pit stop, they got on that right rear adjustment and started adjusting on the chassis, and they adjusted, and they adjusted, and they adjusted. A huge adjustment, and it looks like it's really working for Rusty because his car is much faster now than earlier in the race.
Boy, that team is so famous for that. He knows how he wants the race car to feel, and normally he knows what it's going to take to get it to feel that way, so he tells them, okay, put so many rounds away at Denny, or whatever the case might be. Jeff Gordon, now as we see Mark Martin really putting the pressure on Rusty Wallace, and right in front of him, Jeff Gordon putting the pressure on Dale Garrett there. The first five cars, as you can see, out Martin's windshield.
And Fords are battling for fourth and fifth. We showed you the statistic regarding how many laps Ford has led this year. But right now, first, second, and third are Chevys. Oh, and Jeff Gordon passes Dale Garrett and gets the lead.
Made it look easy.
Uh-oh. See the hood flapping on that 8 car. Remember last week when Jeremy Mayfield lost the hood on his car? If NASCAR sees that, Mr. Burton will be in the pits quickly. As a matter of fact, the guy at the flagman has the black flag in his hand. Now he's already been black flagged.
Boy, it was a miracle that somebody wasn't hurt from that incident last week involving Jeremy Mayfield when the thing sailed off the car and flew through the air like a kite. Earnhardt goes to second, passing Dale Jarrett, but it landed in an area that was unoccupied and nobody was hurt. Now, Burton gave up 23rd position there and, of course, has gone a lap down. And look at the traffic jam at four.
Kenny Wallace got tagged going in three, almost spun out. And now he and Morgan Shepherd almost get together down in one, but meanwhile, everybody's still going forward.
Now watch this jam up as they move through the third turn and go into four. And Kenny does a nice job saving it.
And now Morgan Shepherd's headed to the pits.
Yes, Morgan Shepherd evidently has a flat tire because of that. And Dale Earnhardt has taken the lead.
This is how Dale Jarrett lost the lead to Jeff Gordon a few laps ago in turn three.
He saw that Jeff had a good run on him going into the turn. He just gave him room down there, not taking any chances, and Jeff, with the faster car, moved on around.
And now we can see that Earnhardt, in fact, has the lead. He's taking it away from Jeff Gordon, and Rusty Wallace trying to get by Dale Jarrett for that third spot.
Good battle back here for third, fourth, fifth, and sixth.
And he said go forward, going back out. He's rusty. I don't think there's any question what he's faster than Dale Jarrett, and he's going to make the fast maybe going into turn three. But look at Jeff Bodine shooting by Mark Martin. Bodine is on the move.
Trying his best to get underneath
18 car.
Look at how Jeff Bodine has moved up from lap 123 when he was 12. Now with 203 laps completed, he is up to fifth position and trying to take over fourth from Dale Jarrett.
He'll get him going into turn three. Jarrett will back off. Won't fight him. Mark Martin will come right in there. Two, almost, not quite.
That's one reason that Dale Jarrett did not fight any more than he did, because if he had tried to drive in on the outside of the seventh car, he was going to lose at least one more position. And he's going to lose that position now anyway if Mark Martin gets a run.
Boy, Morton Shepherd come in there with new tires on and almost ran over Dale Jarrett, but Morton did a good job of going high on the racetrack and not getting it. See what those new tires will do. Morton just came out of the pits. He's three laps down now.
Shepard had the break, and that almost created a problem for Darrell Walters.
And now those used tires that Dale Jarrett have is really showing up.
And there is the leader, Dale Earnhardt, who has finished in the top 10 at Bristol 73% of the time, 22 top 10 finishes in 30 Bristol starts. And this is the 25th time that he has led here at the IMAX. Laps, and Jeff Gordon tries to wrestle the lead away from Dale Earnhardt, but can't do it.
Look at Earnhardt up on the high side. Is he letting Jeff Gordon go by, or is he trying to find him another groove, man?
I believe he's trying to find him another groove, Benny. He realizes that Gordon is faster down on the inside, so he's trying to find him a groove up there. And while Gordon's trying to get around him, here comes Rusty Wallace, who's going to make the pass for second.
Rusty moves up a spot, and Wallace leads all drivers in short track points earned thus far in 1994 by 51 over Dale Earnhardt.
Look at that groove that Earnhardt is running. That's the highest I've seen anyone here in 2 years.
Other than Bobby Hamilton, that we've seen him running up there some tonight.
There is Jeff Bodine, who reasserts himself in this race, moving up to fourth.
I tell you what, then, if Earnhardt gets that groove working for him, it's adios, because the traffic will be no problem up there.
That's exactly right. He goes in low, lets it drift up in the center of the corner, and it's working for him here right now.
Oh, Jeff Gordon spins after being hit by Jeff Bodine. Big crash on the back stretch. Gordon went in hard.
Yes, he came off the second corner, just like you said, and evidently he got off the gas, or Jeff Bodine really got a run and nailed Jeff Gordon as he came off the corner, and around went Jeff, and bam!
Big time damage. That's too bad. Jeff had a good run going. Let's take a look at it. Coming off two.
There we see Jeff Gordon and Jeff Bodine, and bam! And watch just how much force that he hits that wall with.
Are in the pits.
And it's our eighth caution of the evening. Jerry.
Dale Earnhardt, our leader, takes the champion's pit spot all the way at the end of pit road. We're watching 3, 2, and 7. Earnhardt, Rusty Wallace, and Jeff Bodine, as they will all three spin here on the first stretch. Back up there.
I tell you what, Rusty Wallace is going to let that right side down so fast, I thought they had changed the tires, and he is moving. Meanwhile, the three car, they're changing the left side tires. Is he going to be able to move first? No. Rusty Wallace goes out. Earnhardt is now second.
Bodine third, then Waltrip. And here's John Kernan in the back pits.
Well, as Rusty Wallace and Dale Earnhardt streak by along with Jeff Bodine, Dale Jarrett just completed a four-tire change. They also took around the wedge out of the right rear.
35 miles an hour is the speed limit on pit road. Jarrett trying carefully not to exceed that. Look at some replays. Here is how Jeff Gordon got into the wall once again.
It looks like he might have not gotten off of turn two. It's certainly not as good as Jeff Bodine. Bodine really had a run coming off of there and just ran right into the back of Jeff Gordon.
Here it is from another angle.
You see the flaps come up?
We understand that Jeff Bodine is being placed at the end of the longest line.
For aggressive driving, overly aggressive driving.
They continue to work on Jeff Gordon's car as Jeff Bodine is being penalized here for over-aggressive driving. We'll be right back with more from Bristol. I'm here at Bristol. We'll go green in one lap. Let's talk to Jeff Gordon. Here's Jerry.
Well, Jeff has climbed out of the DuPont Chevrolet, and Jeff, a tough break for you. What happened out there?
Well, you know, we took two tires, and we didn't have as fresh tires as some of those other guys out there. And I was getting ready to let Jeff go by me. He was obviously faster. And I don't know if he got me loose or what, but, you know, I got loose. I had to get out of the gas, and he got in the back of us.
How bad is the car hurt?
It's bad, you know. I mean, we hit the back end and the inside wall back there pretty hard. You know, I could barely get in here on pit road, so it's going to be a while. You know, we had a great run going, and it's a shame. Bristol just has not been our place. We run good here. We lead every time we come here, and we just can't get the brakes.
Ray Evernham told me this morning they have never finished a race at Bristol, Tennessee, and that record remains intact.
As a result, NASCAR has rescinded the penalty on Jeff Bodine. He's in third place now.
Okay, we'll make that very clear. They did not carry through with the penalty that they threatened.
I think they went down and talked to Jeff Gordon, and once they understood what happened, that he had slipped a little bit coming off of the turn. Jerry?
They originally thought Jeff Bodine was over-aggressive in his driving, and Jeff Bodine immediately on the radio said, hey, Gordon just slowed down, and I ran into him and said, dadgummit, I'm sorry. That's what Jeff Bodine said on the radio. And you heard Gordon a minute ago say he got loose, and when his car got loose, he slowed abruptly, and that's when Bodine got into him. So it was certainly not intentional, thus the rescinding of the penalty.
Very good. Bodine runs in third. The leader of the race is Rusty Wallace. Then Dale Earnhardt, Jeff, Darrell Waltrip.
And Mark Martin is in fifth place. Darrell Waltrip is fourth. Mark Martin is fifth. Bill Elliott, sixth. Harry Gant is seventh. Rick Mast is eighth. Joe Nemechek is ninth. Dale Jarrett, tenth. Sterling Marlin, 11th.
And here is Bodine going to the inside of Earnhardt and taking second position away. Now Bodine sets his sights on the leader, Rusty Wallace, who has now led 15.
Oh, and a spin up here in turn four.
Jeremy Mayfield is sliding down the banking, and everybody else is going to get by okay. And I don't think he touched anything.
And no caution yet, Bob.
The car is way down.
Oh, and it's coming up front of the leader. Man, oh, wow.
Man scared me too dead.
Uh-huh. But he got, everything's okay.
Man, oh man. And looky here at Jeff Bodine. He has caught Rusty Wallace. I think Rusty's spotter told him, look out for Jeremy Mayfield. I think he slowed down. That's one reason that Jeff Bodine was able to catch him as fast as he did.
As I was saying, Rusty has now led 15 of the last 16 short track races. Let's take a look at this again.
Bodine, okay.
Jeremy just went in the corner and lost control and spun right in front of all these cars, and only great driving saved him from getting hit again.
But they pulled.
And there's been a lead change, Bob, while we were showing that replay. Jeff Bodine got around Rusty Wallace.
Jeff Bodine is now the new leader. He has led already tonight.
Watch this. He goes up high, and Bodine goes by.
Now, remember, we have an in-car camera with Jeremy Mayfield or a roof cam. Watch what happens.
Got in there and hit the apron with the left front tire and just spun the car out. Now, meanwhile, Jeff Bodine can probably run a little faster than he is right now, but he's in the lead. He's just going to stay and run that pace, trying to save those tires as much as he can.
Jeremy Mayfield was only one lap down when he spun. He was in 21st position. He is still in 22nd position, but he is now two laps down. There's only one car. There are 20 cars in the lead lap, and only one car that's one lap down, and that is Kyle Petty.
Battle for fourth place, Darrell Waltrip and Mark Martin.
And Mark Martin might get it going into the turn. Yep. Down on the inside, Darrell's not going to fight him too much. He knows it's too early in the race to be fighting someone off there.
And another battle here involves Michael Waltrip and Bobby Hamilton.
Darrell Pontiac.
This is for 13. Hamilton has 13, Michael 14th, then Rudd.
Should be in the 15th position. There's Derek Cope right behind them in the Bobby Allison straight arrow board. Amazing. He hit the wall early in the race, and he's still out there in the lead lap.
All these guys in the lead lap, including Derek Cope and Todd Bodine. Tice tries to get to the inside of Pope in one, and he does.
I see Kenny Walls behind this duo. Ted Musgrave
approaching the halfway mark. They've completed 247 laps. Three from the halfway point with Jeff Bodine leading. There's third and fourth. Earnhardt and Martin. Martin goes into the inside and gets it. Darrell Waltrip closes in on Dale.
Earnhardt was using that higher line there. Now he goes back up there again. He's going to try that one more time.
And look who else has used that high line. Darrell Waltrip. Running extremely high down in one and two. Here's much higher than three and four.
Ram field summary. Time. Cross flags will be shown by Doyle Ford, the flag man, and we'll say goodbye the halfway point. By the way, Jeff Bodine is sort of on a hot and cold streak. He's the current leader. He has two wins, but also a 31st, 33rd, 39th, and a 29th in his last six races.
He either does real good or real bad.
That's right. On the right now is Darrell Waltrip will go by. Well, we have completed now the halfway point, and the race settles down into a rather routine affair, although nothing is ever routine at Bristol. We'll be right back. No baseball? Sure there is. The Little League World Series, and you can see the final game tonight at 10:30 on the Deuce and at noon tomorrow on ESPN. Rain delay in Williamsport, Pennsylvania earlier today is the reason why it was running late, but you can see it tonight and again tomorrow with Cal Northridge against Venezuela. That Northridge team is from the area that the earthquake occurred in?
Exactly. They had all kinds of problems there. Do they have a nickname or something? I read something about that.
Yeah.
I can't remember the nickname.
The Shockers or the Rockers or something. I don't know.
Shockers, I think. You're right.
14th and 15th here, Michael Waltrip and Todd Bodine. Jeff Bodine is the leader of the race.
He just put a lap on the other Bodine,
right.
Brett Bodine.
Right.
Now there's 19 cars on the lead lap, which is still pretty good. We're more than halfway through this race.
We watch Todd Bodine chasing Michael Waltrip. And there's the 40 car up in the high groove once again.
Dale Earnhardt and Darrell Waltrip, I should say, are fourth and fifth.
And we watch Darrell Waltrip. Jeff Bodine has lapped Derek Cope, so that's another car that wasn't a lead lap, a lap down.
The next car, the 18th car, is Kenny Wallace. He's about 3 seconds in front of Jeff Bodine.
Darrell Waltrip has been so successful here at Bristol and on short tracks in general. Now here's Bill Elliott and Harry Gant racing together for sixth.
Gant was their pole sitter at green and white number 33 in his last race here in Bristol.
tonight. Bill Elliott's teammate, Jimmy Spencer, we mentioned earlier, did not make the show. The 27 car went home. Now here's the Busch Beer race recap. The leader is Jeff Bodine, having led the last 25 laps. Nine leaders, nine lead changes, eight caution periods, have total 46 laps, and the average speed is nearing 188 miles an hour. Those that have led a lap include Harry Gant, Mark Martin, Gordon Earnhardt, Jeff Bodine, Dale Jarrett, and Joe Pimachek. For the first time, along with Rusty Wallace, and Kenny Wallace has led one lap. The list of drivers that are out of the race, however, others are behind the wall getting worked on, including Jeff Gordon, Greg Sachs, and Terry Labonte.
Greg Sachs just came back out. Then is that
Did
what
he?
You were about to say?
Yes. Give you a field summary now, and you can see where everybody is running or where they were running last time around. Although positions change so quickly here. Sterling Marlin is in the top 10. Kenny Wallace is 17th, and 18 cars are on the lead lap.
Might be trying to get back in the race. 200 laps.
Gant and Elliott are still fighting for that position of sixth.
Harry Gant's running that low line with the Hoosier tires. Bill Elliott running a little bit higher with the Goodyears.
He's down on the apron there on the left side of the car a couple of times.
Jeff Bodine is coming up on Kenny Wallace in the Havilland Ford, about to put a lap on him. That's the 18th place position.
And another battle involves Hamilton and Todd Bodine for 13th. And for those of you just joining us, the good news that Jerry Punch reported to us earlier tonight, Ernie Irvin, who normally is in that 28 car, has been taken off the critical list, upgraded to Sirius. Kenny Wallace substituting for him has just lost a lap.
Look at Rusty Wallace. He's closing up on Jeff Bodine.
Rusty Wallace running in second position. Martin third, Dale Earnhardt fourth, and Darrell Waltrip is fifth. We open up the second half of the NASCAR Winston Cup short track season here at Bristol Raceway in Tennessee with the Goodies 500 tonight. The first four short track races of 94 have been won by four different drivers. Ernie Irvin, Dale Earnhardt, Terry Labonte, and Rusty Wallace. Right now, Jeff Bodine is leading, but Rusty Wallace is not too far behind, and we ride with him. Now he puts a lap on Ricky Rudd, who is running in 16th position. So 15 cars now on the lead lap.
And Mark Martin, he's back there at that Babylon Ford as he gets alongside Ricky Rudd. We can see he's only three or four car lengths behind Rusty Wallace. And the leader isn't that far ahead.
Joe Nemechek brings her down pit road. He spun in turn four. He was running eighth.
Some heavy damage to that right side of that car.
Here's Jerry.
He cut a right front tire and was able to make the quick, sharp left-hand turn down off the banking. A couple of cars able to avoid him, keep him from T-boning into the side. And will change right side and left side tires on the Meineke car. And I'm told that they're going to hold him 15 seconds for being too fast on pit road. The pit road speed is 35 miles an hour. The NASCAR official standing in front of the car once they complete the tire change, it will hold him 15 seconds.
That was sort of inevitable, Jerry. He cut the tire and kind of lost it up in turn four, and he had no time whatsoever to brake before entering the pits, but it was probably worth it.
And we can see that Mark Martin has passed Rusty Wallace for that second spot. And Jeff Bodine had all kinds of problems getting by the 40 car, but he finally got by him.
fifth, sixth, and seventh positions are Waltrip, Elliott, and Gann as they lap Brad Teague. Bill Elliott, since lap 210, has moved from 11th to 6th. He moved to 6th on lap 230 and has remained there.
Now another car has gone a lap down. Bobby Hamilton in the Kendall Pontiac. There are 13 cars on the lead lap. Michael Waltrip being shown in the 13th position, and Jeff Bodine is very close to Michael.
Nearing the 300 lap mark. Now Elliott gets a good bite off the corner, had a notion but couldn't make the pass.
Now he comes up under Darrell as Darrell goes high in the turn. There's Harry Gann. He's in on that action too, and he's going to move on the inside. DW won't fight him.
Darrell
go.
Darrell Waltrip has been running at the finish of 33 straight NASCAR Winston Cup races.
That's we see that. Group, and there's the leader. So they're almost a little bit more than a half lap down to the leader, Jeff Bodine.
13 cars on the lead lap. As we're less than five laps away from the 300 lap mark, Jeff Bodine, who began this race from outside the front row, is leading. He's led 58 of the first 294 laps. Back at Bristol, a tire obviously is not where it should be. It has come off Bobby Hamilton's car, who has crashed along with a couple of others on the main straightaway, and pit stops are happening. We'll show you what happened a little bit later. Let's cover the pit stops. Here's Jerry.
As it was a break for Jeff Bodine, he's pitted on lap 223, and the car had just begun to slow as the tires were about gone away after about 75 laps. Mark Martin also in, and once again, they make an adjustment on Mark Martin's car. He complains the car was just too tight. You see the whole field now on pit road. That's Earnhardt sitting at the far end of pit road. Rusty's already off. He is down pit road. Here is Jeff Bodine away, Mark Martin away, and they still work on Dale Earnhardt's car on the left side.
Evidently, they've got an air wrench broken or something on the right rear of that car.
And they're going to have to hurry. The caution car is coming off of turn four. They get it away. Stay at the lead lap.
Rusty Wallace gets off pit road first.
Now, the question is, did they fix Earnhardt's problem, or does he have to come back in? And look at the right rear tire is gone off the 40 car.
He's coming back.
Here it is from Ted Musgraves in car.
There goes the tire that we saw.
Rolled about three-fourths of the way around the racetrack. Jerry, is Earnhardt in again?
Yes, he is. He just came back in, and they were able trying to tighten the lug nuts on the right side. Obviously an air wrench problem. Andy Petra here rolling up the hose. Andy, what was the problem with the car?
Must have had a wrench break right there. We're having to come back in and change left right now.
So they're going to bring him back in and change left side tires. They had an air wrench fail on the right rear. They brought him back in that time just to get the lug nuts tight on the right rear. And now he'll come back down pit road here at 35 miles per hour, and they will change left side tires. The six-time Winston Cup champion, an eight-time winner here in Bristol, Tennessee. And they take the left side tires off. Father-in-law Hal Houston giving him a nice cold drink there through the left side window. They got the left side lug nuts on, dropped it off the jack, and he is down and away.
Now we will show you again what happened to Bobby Hamilton. There's the missing right rear tire and considerable damage to the front and the side of the car.
He also hit the 22 car. We might add that he hit Bobby Labonte as Labonte was going by there. And I don't know if the rear tire fell off the car is why he crashed, or if it was knocked off him when he made contact with the wall.
It's a good thing that tire didn't go into the grandstand or was hit by somebody, because it was traveling at a high rate of speed there.
He's trying to make a lap up. Just going right on around the racetrack. See right here in a moment, it has some fans as it comes around here. Well, didn't quite go that far.
All right, Jerry, what was wrong? Wrench?
Here's what happened. This is the race they were trying to use. Now, I'll have Nelson Crozier hold it as if we were putting it under a lug nut. Now, watch the end here. I'm going to put pressure on it, and nothing happens. The handle is broken, so they were doing all they could. It makes all the noise. It does all the vibration, but it does not tighten the lug nut. That's what cost Dale Earnhardt some valuable time and spots on the racetrack. Bob?
A lot of noise, no action for Dale Earnhardt, who falls way back to 11th position, I believe, for the restart.
Well, fortunately for him, now there are only 12 cars on the lead lap, so it didn't hurt him as bad as it would have earlier.
Martin came in first, comes out third. Jeff Bodine stays the same. Rusty Wallace gained two positions. Bill Elliott stayed in fourth. And Dale Earnhardt from fifth all the way back to 12th position for the restart. The enthusiasm continues here among the crowd at Bristol International. We've just gone green here at Bristol once again with Rusty Wallace up front. Jeff Bodine is running in second. Rick Mast in car one is 13th a lap down. Behind this group, there is all kinds of activity going on. Look at this mess.
And Earnhardt's right in the middle of it.
He doesn't want to be in there, but he had no choice as a result of the problems they had in the pits.
Can be dangerous to get caught back here in the middle of the field when positions are being traded and everybody's going for position.
I really think this is an important race for Dale Earnhardt. I think if he gets through this race and doesn't lose too many points, if he finishes in the top 10, he'll go on and win the championship.
That's an interesting observation.
Yeah.
But why? Just because
anything can happen at this racetrack, and it can happen so fast, and there's nothing you can do about it.
You have a better control over
your destiny
at places like Darlington, where we'll be next weekend, and North Wilkesboro and Martinsville. And...
Well, sometimes it's tough to have control over your destiny at Darlington. But I agree, you have more control than you do on this racetrack, but it's still tough.
Look at Jeff Bodine. He is right up on the back bumper again of Rusty Wallace.
He was able to get by Rick Mast.
Now, Mast had just gone a lap down just before the caution came out. His tires had simply gone away. He had been running up there in the top 10, and all of a sudden they were passing him, and he went a lap down.
Earnhardt is up in that high groove again, passing Derek Cope.
Well, here comes Cope back on the inside, but Earnhardt has the run off the turn. Pass.
Todd Bodine is going to try it up there. See if he has as much success. Nope.
Todd is still in the lead lap. He was just about to go a lap down when this last caution came out. So that was a blessing for he and Michael Walter both. They were just in front of Jeff Bodine.
There's Bodine.
And we can see that Jeff Bodine's car runs through the middle of the corner faster than Rusty Wallace's, which enables him to go down the straightaway or come off the corner with a great deal more acceleration than Rusty.
Rusty has the advantage down the straightaways, but Jeff really gets through the corners. Here are your top five in NASCAR Winston Cup points. Earnhardt, starting 14th, now 10th. Irvin, of course, is recuperating from the injuries, but doing well. Mark Martin started 8th, now 3rd. Rusty is the leader, and Ken Schrader started 31st, currently running in 20th position, but is, what,
three laps down?
Yeah.
Lost those three laps during an unscheduled pit stop early for a flat tire, and just as then the caution came out not long after that, so he's been caught that way all night long.
Rusty Wallace has an amazing... There is Bill Elliott and Harry Gant. These guys have been running together, seems like, for most of the race.
Well, for a good portion of the last 100 laps or so, but Gant takes the position away from Bill Elliott.
That is fourth, so Elliott back to fifth.
No thing wrong with that picture. They're missing Darrell Walker. Oh, there's Darrell. I knew he'd be in that picture in just a second.
There he is.
And right behind Darrell Walker is Sterling Marlin in the Kodak car. There he comes into the picture, the yellow car. He is running in the seventh position.
And this is his 300th NASCAR Winston Cup start. There is Dale Jarrett, who is running in eighth position. Kenny Wallace has lost a lap. He is 15th. There's Dick Trickle.
Trickle is running in the ninth position, still in the lead lap.
Earnhardt trying to weave his way through the traffic and get back up into competition after the misfortune on pit road. Here's a couple of the Bodines running together, Todd and Brett.
Brett's a lap down.
Along with Rudd and Michael Waltrip.
Brett being shown in the 16th position. Gordon Shepherd there in the Citgo Ford. He's four laps down.
Now Waltrip trying to take over fifth from Elliott.
See what a disadvantage running high is. Bill Elliott running low on the racetrack pulls away from Darrell Waltrip by about a half a car length. Now, if they run across traffic, Darrell closes up right on the back bumper of Bill. But you can see what a huge advantage is to run on the bottom of the racetrack.
Earnhardt is trying to tell Dick Trickle that he believes he has the faster car and that Trickle should relinquish the position. Dick Trickle has other ideas.
He's not intimidated.
And so Earnhardt will go up top. Long way around up there. I think he's going to do it.
It's a good pass on the outside by Earnhardt. Here comes Todd Bodine, the factory store's car. Dick Trickle racing for what? Ninth spot?
Ninth, 10th, and 11th here. That battle is for 10th between Trickle and Bodine. And up front, it is Rusty Wallace, who has an average finish of 2nd in the last 15 short track races.
An average finish of 2.0, huh?
Yep.
Wow.
That's pretty strong.
It is. It's very strong.
And he leads here tonight, looking for his 5th victory here at Bristol International Raceway, but his 1st in this night fall race. We'll be back with more live coverage of the Goodies 500 after this. Did you notice that Benny said, come on, guys, push,
yes,
while he walked alongside?
Now, watch what these horses do as they accelerate off the corner. Here's Mark Martin. He's in 2nd place. There's leader Jeff Bodine. 700 ponies accelerating from, what, 100 miles an hour up to 135 miles an hour in 600 feet or something like that.
Rusty Wallace got past. Jeff Bodine used a little of that horsepower that he's got under his hood to move around.
Rusty, of course, has fallen back to 3rd now as Mark Martin is in the 2nd. Jerry?
Well, Mark Martin has got a problem. He has been told by NASCAR that he has an exhaust pipe or something dragging beneath the car. As he goes to the corner, you see the spark from beneath the car number 6, and he follows Jeff Bodine in turns 1 and 2. Up in 3 and 4, it was quite as bad. The Valvoline pit, Steve Bill and the crew are getting ready to and we are told that Bill Elliott is also slowing down and lost the position.
I believe Jerry might have lost the cylinder. I'm not sure. He just seemed like he's not running as quite as fast on the straightaway. Sterling Marlin has moved around him now as Terry Labonte is back out on the racetrack right now. Sterling Marlin has taken over 5th from Bill Elliott. Definitely not running quite as fast as he was. Maybe there's no major problem for him.
John Kernan has more.
A few laps ago, coming out of turn number 2, Bill Elliott got so far sideways, I thought he was going to end up down here on pit road on the backstretch. But somehow he managed to save the car and keep it going in a straight line. That was when Sterling Marlin made his move and caught up a lot of ground on Bill.
Dale Earnhardt has picked up a couple of positions here as he has moved to 8th. And Jerry has more on Mark Martin.
We are now being told it is actually the strap that holds the exhaust pipe in position beneath the car. That strap is either vibrating loose or broken, and that is what is dragging beneath the Valvoline Ford. The car bouncing at a turn, one of these sparks as the strap is...
And we have a crash crash in the back stretch as Mike Wallace is up against the fence on the high side, and Ken Schrader is against the fence on the inside. And Rusty Wallace, as I was watching that live, got nailed pretty good in the rear end of the car. I don't know how that'll affect the performance of it, but I think it was Kyle Petty who hit him in the rear end.
Almost drove Rusty into the wreck, as a matter of fact.
Yeah, here it is again.
There we see Wallace coming off the corner. He goes up by himself, loses control, backs it in the fence. Not a lot of contact with the wall, but now as he comes back across the racetrack, wow, Jeremy Mayfield knocked off the rear bumper as the 52 car spun out. Jerry Punch.
Now, with this pit stop, everyone down here where we are should be able to go the rest of the way on fuel. The tires could be a different story. Here is Mark Martin. Watch him. They will change four tires. As you watch the 7, 6, and 2, that is Jeff Bodine, Mark Martin, and Rusty Wallace. Now they're going to put a strap on the left side exhaust, bring the strap up and try to hold it up, hold the exhaust pipe up. Rusty is down and away in the car number two. Here is Bodine down and away. Now left side tires going on Mark Martin's car. Mark Martin is down off the jack, and he is down and away. He and Darrell Walter race to the end of pit road. Let's go to John Turner.
James Sterling Marlin, Michael Walter, and Todd Bodine. They also tightened up Sterling Marlin's car. He is the first one to leave. Dale Jarrett also leaves pit road with four tires. There goes Michael Walter, and Todd Bodine follows behind.
Dale Jarrett also moving out of the back pits. Rusty Wallace's crew once again gets him out first, and he will have the lead when we go back to racing.
And we saw Jeremy Mayfield take the bumper, rear bumper off the 90 car. Watch this.
Mayfield had all kinds of problems. He's the one that hit Ken Schrader in the back end. Here's from Mark Martin. Man. John Kernan has more on Sterling Marlin.
Well, earlier in the race, Sterling Marlin got into the back of somebody and pushed in his grill. Well, they've been fighting a near overheating problem all race long. Right now, Sterling, during this caution period, from the time he pitted, went back out, the water temperature went up from 240 to 250 degrees. So they are going to bring Sterling back in while we're under caution and put some water into that car.
That might be easier said than done. Well, no. Getting the hood up was fairly easy. Sometimes when you bend the hood up like that and come in to try to get it up, it's very difficult to do, but
they are trying their best. 358 laps are complete here at Bristol in the Goodies 500 NASCAR Winston Cup race. Less than a lap of green complete here in the Goodies 500 at Bristol. Rusty Wallace leads the race. Jeff Bodine is second. Harry Gant is third, the pole sitter.
Bill Elliott is in fourth place, and Dale Earnhardt is fifth.
Elliott and Musgrave running together do not pass. Earnhardt is once again up on the high side. Passing cars right and left.
So his car is, there's Derek Cope, he is a lap down. Darrell Walker in sixth place, right behind Earnhardt. As they get to close quarters, Mark Martin in seventh. He lost a lot of positions on that pit stop as they tried to repair that damage that, or whatever that was hanging down, Jerry Punch had reported. But he's going to get one of those positions back there on the inside of Darrell Walker. But he's running up on Jerry Mayfield. Yep, he makes the pass.
Wallace and Bodine still going at it.
Yes. Jeff Bodine was able to get by Rick Maston. You can see that he is faster than Rusty Wallace right now.
Well, what will happen in 75 laps or so if we stay green?
And I think Mark Martin will probably be the fastest car on the racetrack. Where he'll be in the running is yet to be seen.
But those Hoosier tires are fast when they're new. What Jeff Bodine has on his X-side batteries forward, and he's going to make a pass.
Yes, he is. So Bodine goes back into the lead, and the 33 of Harry Gant is really closing in on second place Rusty Wallace. Well, Hoosier started first and second with Gant and Jeff Bodine, and currently they are running first and third with Rusty Wallace between them. The car of Terry Labonte, by the way, Benny, is back on the track. He's about 294 or so laps behind.
Ned, you're right. These Hoosiers are really fast, but I think there's too many laps, about 130 laps to go. So if the caution flags drop just right, they're in good shape. If it goes green the rest of the way.
Jeff Bodine is number one here in Bristol. Lake Speed is eight laps down in 23rd. We ride on top of his Quality Care Ford.
John Andretti still out there running.
It's Jeff Burton, the Revestis car. That's the one we had in the track pack just a moment ago with all the horsepower.
Whoa! And on the racetrack live, Martin and Earnhardt are going at it for fifth position.
Well, they're not going at it any longer. Mark Martin just passed Earnhardt and took the position away.
Dale, of course, had a bad air wrench on a recent pit stop. Here's a Napa field summary.
Mark Martin had a long pit stop this last caution flag when he went in and he tried to put a brace or a strap under whatever was dragging the racetrack. And he is working his way back towards the front as best he can. Chevrolet. Boy, that car runs good at this racetrack.
Yes, it does. Last week, unfortunate incident took him out early. He finished 37th. That was his worst finish in the last 65 races, dating back to Talladega in July of 1992. All right, let's move back up front and see how Mr. Bodine is doing. Well, the interval is about 5-6 car lengths over Rusty Wallace, and then a little bit more than that back to Harry Gant. Dale Jarrett and Dick Trickle are battling for eighth.
Jarrett's car seemed to be pushing a little bit off the turns. He got pushed there a little bit by Trickle, and he's going to let him go by. Michael Waltrip right there, too, and Pinzol Pontiac.
Dale's had a good race, though. I mean, no doubt about it. He didn't start very high up, but he's been on the lead lap all race long.
He started 29th.
Here is Mark Martin. To fourth,
taking that spot away from Bill Elliott. Now he's Martin a little bit more than a straightaway behind Harry Gant in third place.
And now Michael Waltrip picks up the battle with Dale Jarrett.
And I'd like to say hello to Mark Hayes, one of the guys that works on this 30 car.
As you see his progression from lap 300 from 12th to 10th, go ahead.
Well, he's battling a cancer problem. He lives in Yaginville, North Carolina. Saw him at the softball game Tuesday night. He's looking good, and all I can say is, Mark, keep fighting.
Did you play?
He softball? He told him about it.
Did you play softball?
No, I told him all about it.
What would you play if you played softball, Benny? Second base?
Backstop, I guess.
Well, that's even better.
Right here is where Dale Jarrett's losing it off turn two. His car is just pushing there. He can't get off of that turn.
Got
that run on him. And there's Sterling Marlin coming up. He'll be the next one.
Michael to ninth, Dale to 10th. Marlin is 11th, and then Todd Bodine in 12th, and those are the cars on the lead lap. All four cars there battling for position.
Yeah, Dale Jarrett gets through 3 and 4 pretty good, doesn't he?
Yeah,
Dale?
Gets through 3 and 4, okay. Coming off of turn 2 right here is where he has been losing. See Michael pull away from him coming off there?
Uh-huh.
The car
car is tight, which it appears to me that it is. It might work itself out as he runs on a little bit more. But they see him move right back up on Waltrip coming off of turn four. Now he gets a pretty good run off of turn two.
Dine is trying to head up the racetrack and see if he can't get by Sterling up there in the high group.
He's doing a pretty good job of it, isn't he?
Yeah.
Just move right around. Meanwhile, Morgan Shepherd watches all this.
He's working his laps down. Now Jarrett trying to make the pass back on Michael Walter, and he's going to get it. Todd Bodine will try to make the pass as well. And he'll probably get it this turn. He does.
Marlin comes inside and passes.
Oh, Dale Jarrett spins out, coming off of turn four, right in front of that group.
Heavy contact with the outside wall. Everybody's going to miss him, and Ken Schrader tried to get a lap back. I don't know whether he did or not. He's five laps down, but tried to get one back. Dale Jarrett with a spin and heavy contact in the front of the car off of turn four. However, he has the car rolling again, or trying to get it rolling.
Well, he's coming. There he is in front. He just, I don't know if he cut a tire or what happened. They think they cut a tire, and around it goes. You can see the front end hit the wall pretty hard.
Yes, sir. But he has the Interstate Battery Chevrolet rolling down the front stretch, pulling it behind the wall. Here's another angle. No help.
No, it just goes around all of a sudden.
Jerry Punch is in Rusty Wallace's pit.
Right side tires already out. Remember, this crew had some problems last week in Michigan, but they have been flawless here tonight at Bristol, Tennessee. Left side tires going out. Lug nuts. He is down off the jack, and pit road is very, very busy, and he heads back to turn one. Bodine is out. Earnhardt is still in. Here is Bill Elliott out. Here is Darrell Waltrip out, and now Earnhardt in the Goodwood Chevrolet heads back to turn one as well.
How about Harry Gant? Came out in third spot. Looked to me like... their job.
This is our 11th caution of the evening, as 390 of the 500 laps of it. The big glow off the front of the helicopter is not a fire. It's the brightly illuminated Bristol International Raceway, and our overhead shots are courtesy of Steel, makers of a full line of outdoor power equipment. Powerful, easy to use, durable. Qualities you can depend on in Steel territory. Take a look at the pit summary. Jeff Bodine stayed first. Wallace stayed second. Gant stayed third. Martin from fourth to sixth, and Bill Elliott stayed in fifth position. So not a whole lot of change during those most recent pit stops.
So you plugged Dale Earnhardt in that fourth spot.
That was the only spot that we had missing. Earnhardt takes that spot. Moved from sixth to fourth on the pit stop.
Under caution because of an accident involving Dale Jarrett in turn four.
Well, he's coming around there. He just passed the Michael Waltrip. All of a sudden, the back end of the Interstate Battery Chevrolet goes around, and the front end goes into the wall.
You can see Morgan Shepherd's car just passing by. Here's how it looked from the roof cam of his car. A lot of smoke, and you just hope you'll miss him. He did. Here's John Kernan with Dale Jarrett.
Well, Dale is still sitting in his car. They're working to put a new oil cooler on, a new radiator. What he radioed and told his crew coach Jimmy Maygar when he went into the turn, it felt like he cut a tire down. But a survey of all four tires showed that all four are inflated. I asked Dale through the window net if he knew exactly what had happened. If someone had touched him or whatever. He said, I don't know. He put his hands up like as if to say, I don't know what happened.
No, nothing. No one hit him. That's for sure, John. He was by himself, by a car lamp or so there. Well, if it wasn't a tire, he just lost it, I guess.
Pretty much it.
You see the flashlights there trying to assess the damage and just see exactly what is wrong with the car.
Let's take a look at how they came off of pit road. Boy, one thing you got to do tonight is give a lot of credit to Harry Gant's crew, who have been turning in some outstanding pit stops. He's a fourth car back here, and watch.
We see the green and white car. That's Gant. Rusty Wallace moves, and here comes Gant, almost beating Rusty Wallace out. There comes Earnhardt.
is Jeff Bodine, who won the battle off pit road. Rusty Wallace second, then Harry Gant, Dale Earnhardt, and Bill Elliott. Back in a moment. We have just gone green, three quarters of a lap completed with Jeff Bodine showing the way. A near crash in the backstretch, but everybody is okay. Here's a big group of cars. Dale Earnhardt, Kenny Wallace, Bill Elliott, Ricky Rudd, Mark Martin, and others. Watch Rudd there. Here's a pretty interesting statistic. Rudd has scored more points in the last six races than any other driver. I'm not so sure that he'll be able to claim that after tonight because he is 14th a lap down, but the last six races have been very good ones for Ricky Rudd.
At 28 car, once again, this one in is Kenny Wallace. He's substituting for Ernie Irvin while Ernie recuperates up in Ann Arbor.
Off the critical list. Here's the restart. Here's that near crash I was talking about from our remote control cam off of turn two. Oh, boy.
Looks like 52 car Brad Teague did get in the wall. Here's a race for second place.
Well, the question now becomes, can the Hoosiers pull off another win here? Jerry Punch.
Bob, the Hoosier engineers are very, very excited. Early in the race, the wear wasn't that good. They were getting about 70 laps, then 80 laps, then 90 laps. Now they feel that comfortably the tire will last 100 laps. That's how many laps are left in this race. And two of the top three have the Hoosier tires on. So for the 7 and 33, it looks pretty good right now.
Indeed it does. If they can go 100 laps, they'll pull off the victory because we went green with just 101 or 102 laps to go. There is the third place, Harry Gant on Hoosiers with Rusty Wallace on Goodyear's ahead in second.
Gant had Rick Mast between he and Rusty not long ago. He had disposed of Rick Mast and is picking up on.
And Mark Martin just passed Bill Elliott for that spot. Took over, what is it, fifth spot?
Uh-huh. Fifth, sixth, and seventh right here. Martin, Elliott, and Walter.
Carroll looks on the inside of Bill. Bell's car didn't run very well there. Oh, about the last 100 laps, but it looks like he might have the handle back on the Western Auto Chevy.
Bristol starts have 12 wins, 23 top fives, 29 top tens, the best record of all active drivers. Darrell Waltrip.
What did he do, win seven races in a row here one time?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Some kind of a record on this racetrack. And he did it by being a very smart race driver.
Very patient. Walter, by the way, has had three top 10 finishes in the last three races.
As we watch this race for sixth spot, Jeff Bodine is still leading. Rusty Wallace is second. Harry Gant third.
Everybody going high to miss John Andretti, who had his problems early on, made repairs, and is out there running at a much slower speed than everybody else. There is Jeff Bodine, the leader. Rusty Wallace in second, and Harry Gant third. Now, on Speed Week tonight, we talked to Harry Gant, and he said that even though he, because of his pole here tonight, has a position in the Busch Clash at Daytona in 95, he would hold to his retirement and not compete in it.
He's not running the Busch Clash.
Now the question is, will this racetrack have a representative in that Busch Clash in 95? Because remember the guy who won the pole for the race here in the spring?
Chuck Bown?
Chuck Bown, who is not in the series.
Oh, and here's Lake Speed.
Lake Speed hits the wall on the inside of the front stretch. Keeps going.
And no caution.
How about that? A lot of damage, though, to the quality care Ford of Lake Speed, who is in 22nd position, nine laps down.
And we can see that he is
still out there.
In the meantime, Terry Labonte has parked the Kellogg's Cornflake Chevrolet. we see all the smoke inside Lake Speed's car.
Terry Labonte pulled into the garage area, what is the garage area, the infield here, immediately after Lake Speed had made contact with the wall. I believe those two had a meeting earlier in the evening, didn't they?
Yes, they did.
They did, and looks like they had another one right here.
You'll see Lake come down.
Oh. Now battle for fourth position between Earnhardt and Mark Martin.
Earnhardt had a pretty good lead on Mark Martin not long ago, but Martin has run him down.
I believe Mark Martin might have the best car here tonight, but he got behind when he had that long pit stop due to the, here comes Darrell Walter by Bill Elliott. Martin had that long pit stop and got behind, and he's having trouble getting caught back up.
And there goes Martin to the inside of Earnhardt as the drivers now begin to see the laps click off. We're down to 80 to go, and Martin makes his move. By the way, remember here in the spring, he came from a year ago, rather, in this race, he came from two laps down to win.
Bumper. Everyone on the front grandstand stood up.
Yep.
They thought he was going to see a wreck.
And now we have Rusty Wallace challenging Bodine for the lead. Wow. And just behind Rusty is Gant. This is a good three-car battle here.
Jeff Bodine had several car length advantage on Rusty Wallace a couple of laps ago, and he has seen that lead just vanish. It might have been that he ran up on the 90 car and got off the gas, and that's how Rusty was able to catch him.
Remember what happened to Rusty a year ago. He dominated this race, leading 409 of the 500 miles, but he admittedly just became so fatigued that he couldn't hold his head up and lost the race because of that. 75 laps to go here at Bristol. It's Jeff Bodine, Rusty Wallace for Ford, Harry Gant for Chevy, Mark Martin for Ford, and Dale Earnhardt for Chevy in the top five.
Back in Bristol, Tennessee, with less than 70 laps to go and possibly a problem for our leader. Jeff Bodine in the Exide Battery Ford has radioed to his crew and said, we may be out of water. Danny Glad, the engine builder, just told me they may have a pinhole in the radiator and they may have been leaking water. Apparently now we are seeing smoke from the 7 car. Bodine just radioed this and it is very, very hot. The engine temperature is extremely hot, and it could be curtains for the car number 7.
Right now, he maintains the lead by about a couple of car lengths over Rusty Wallace, but we'll keep an eye on that situation. Meanwhile, there's a good battle for ninth position going on between Todd Bodine and the 4 car of Sterling Marlin. Also, Michael Waltrip is involved in that. 3 car battle for ninth.
9th, 10th, and 11th that we're seeing right there on the screen. Todd Bodine in the blue and red car, number 75. Two yellow cars, so Sterling Marlin number 4 and Michael Waltrip number 30. Brad Tigg still hanging in there in that car number 52. Third position, 20 laps down.
You know, Jerry Punch talked about the 7 car being out of water. Well, you know, why don't he go to 10th? Well, he's trying to win the race, and maybe he has a gauge, a water gauge that's malfunctioning, so he's got to stay on the racetrack. But if he is out of water and this thing blows up, we're looking at taking out himself, Rusty Wallace, and Harry Gant. There's the water hose. They're ready in case he should come in.
He stretched out the lead on Wallace.
Yeah, but Mark Martin is gaining on the whole crowd, though. He is really coming up through there. There's the three leaders. Here, there's Mark Martin, just barely came into the picture.
Here's a Napa field summary, how the drivers were running last time around. There There's the six car. There are your top four right there in the shot.
And it's a great race. 60 laps to go. But if Jeff Bodine can finish the race, can Mark Martin get up there? Can he pass all those cars and get to the front?
Easier said than done.
Easier said than done. That's correct.
Yeah, but he's driving like a man with a mission, and he does have a mission. He is gaining. Now Rusty has moved right back up on Jeff Bodine once again.
Jeff has encountered some slower traffic. Jeremy Mayfield is just ahead of him.
Inducted into the National Motorsports Press Association Hall of Fame next weekend in Darlington.
And we will be in Darlington for the annual Labor Day tradition, the Mountain Dew Southern 500.
500 laps of the track, too tough to tame.
Miles.
500 miles, yes.
Ooh, look at this. Merlin and Bodine.
Spot, 9th, 10th, and 11th.
Average speed of the race, 90.1. We're about 11 miles an hour under the track record. We have been slowed by 10 caution periods, for a total of 68 laps. 90 car of Mike Wallace has returned to competition after being behind the wall. 42 laps down. Here's Michael Waltrip looking to the inside of Marlin, who tries to get to the inside of Bodine.
This battle has been raging for 100 laps or so, hasn't it?
It sure has.
Marlin's got a ride on him going into turn three. Does Todd know he's there? Yes, he does.
Here comes Michael, going to take that other spot away. So Todd goes from 9th to 11th, just like that.
The battle on the same straightaway with Dale as they look into turn three. Turn two.
There's Rusty Wallace looking at the lead of the race, Jeff Bodine.
Rusty is driving once again Midnight, which has 11 wins and 23 of 25 top fives.
Well, you know, last year he raced the Pontiac, and you say, well, how can that be? Because this year you have the Ford. All they did was put skin, Ford skin, on the chassis that he had the Pontiac skin on last year.
Same basic car.
Jeff coming up on his brother Brett, put another lap on him.
Let's be coming back in the action. Ford quality gear car. What do you think? Does Rusty know that Jeff Bodine has a problem then?
I don't know.
I don't think so.
I started to mention a moment ago that I felt that maybe Rusty was biding his time there. Mark Martin had really been gaining on them, but now all of a sudden he's sort of settled in back there. He hasn't gained in the last 10 laps. And so I thought maybe he was just riding along there behind Bodine, but not taking any chance of trying to pass him. But I don't know. If he knows that he has that problem, he should be trying to pass him, because as you said earlier, if he should blow up right in front of that little boy, that wouldn't be much Rusty could do about it.
As a matter of fact, Dale Earnhardt might be gaining on Mark Martin now.
Oh, there he goes. He blew it up right there. Down the front straightaway.
Jeff Bodine drops from the lead. And a lot of smoke coming from the exhaust headers of that car. Here is Jerry Punch.
Well, as you said a minute ago, Jeff Bodine had no choice but to try to run to the finish of this race. The car actually ran about 24 laps with little or no water in it.
And now he sits here. There's a light on the dash indicating that the engine is overheating and there's very little water circulating. Bodine sits patiently. The light now glows inside the car. They will change tires and they try to add water to the engine, but obviously his chances of going to victory lane are over.
Jeff Bodine will not win at Bristol. The Unocal bonus money still remains up for grabs, though, as Harry Gant, who started from the pole position, now has second to Rusty Wallace, and the caution is out as Dick Trickle crashes here on the straightaway. Dick Trickle.
And this just might be the break that Harry Gant, look, he's running second, but
yep.
We said all night, those Hoosier tires are faster. Trickle tries to get going again, Gant will get four new tires, and he only has about 40 laps to go, so it might be just what he needs.
Well, track position becomes vitally important at this moment. Let's see how things shake out as the cars come down pit road for what could be the final series of pit stops. Rusty Wallace has stopped already. Harry Gant now stopping. Mark Martin, Dale Earnhardt, Bill Elliott, and Darrell Waltrip are also in.
See Rusty's crew going around to the left side already. Harry's crew just now going around to the left. Mark Martin drops that car down. Rusty's car is moving. He's moving. Harry Gant, they're still up on the left side. Rusty takes the lead. Here comes Harry. Mark Martin's going to be third. Earnhardt second. And Harry goes back to fourth. That might beat him then.
Yeah, it might do it. He's going to have to race awfully hard if he can get by Mark Martin and Dale Earnhardt, which are two tough customers to pass, before he could even get to Rusty Wallace.
There are 39 laps to go in the Goodies 500. Rusty Wallace is leading. We'll be back in a moment.
Back in Bristol, Tennessee, less than 40 laps to go, and Jeff Bodine, unfortunately, your day is over after an outstanding effort.
Yeah, hi, Kathy. Sorry. Car owner's back home watching. We burnt the engine up. The water pump broke, let all the water out. We knew it was low. Well, we kept going, hoping it was going to make it, but just too many laps left. It got really hot, burned a piston, seal or something went out of the water pump. But the Exide Ford was pretty much hauling the mail. It's running really good. Proud of the team. Pit stops are great. Hoosier tires are working great. Setup was really good. You know, this really makes us feel good. I mean, I feel bad that we're out of the race, but to run this good consistently, that's what we've been trying to, where we've been trying to put this team. It's there now. It's a shame what happened tonight.
Indeed it is. Back to green flag racing, guys.
And Rusty Wallace gets a pretty good jump on Dale Earnhardt, Mark Martin, Harry Gant, Darrell Waltrip, and Bill Elliott.
Yeah, Harry Gant caught up in some lap traffic. He is losing time to the leader, so if those Hoosier tires are going to be better, he's going to have to use them up before he can even get around the lap track.
The next 35 laps will go away very, very quickly.
Yeah, these things happen at this racetrack awfully fast. Leader Rusty Wallace, Dale Earnhardt in second. This is looking from the third place car of Mark Martin.
It's not as far as it looks from that roof camera. About four cars separate Earnhardt and Wallace, about the same separates Mark Martin and Earnhardt.
The top three, the top four in NASCAR Winston Cup points are running in the top three, of course, considering Ernie Irvin, who is recuperating from his injuries.
Now Harry Gant has cleared the last of that traffic. He just went around Rick Mast as Mark Martin moves in on Dale Earnhardt. Rusty Wallace has pulled away a little bit on Earnhardt. Earnhardt slows.
He just pulls over and says, okay, Mark, you've got a fast race car. Go see if you can catch him.
Earnhardt thinking about those points.
We can see that Mark Martin is pulling away from Earnhardt by a car length or two. You know, Bob, remember a couple years ago I went down to the Ridgewood Barbecue and did a buffet, Benny?
Uh-huh.
Well, my boss, our boss from ESPN, Bob Scanlon, came in Friday, so I said, let's go to lunch. Take him down to Ridgewood Barbecue to really treat him some great barbecue.
Are you sure you want to tell this story? Is your contract that secure?
You must, Skellinhead. A bacon cheeseburger. I said, man. He probably ordered barbecue at Crystal. Man.
I think I'll not walk with you back to the TV compound after this one is over.
Might not have a job, huh? Rusty Wallace appears to be maybe pulling away a little bit from Mark Martin. Mark Martin's definitely pulling away from Earnhardt.
And Jerry has more on Dale Earnhardt. He's just about to lose third, Jerry.
Well, a true show of sportsmanship. Earnhardt told Childress and Carlton, hey, we can't do anything with Rusty Wallace. We can't run with him tonight. So why keep Mark Martin from getting an opportunity to Dale? Just pulled over and let Mark go by. Say, Mark, you take your best shot because we don't have enough to run with him.
While victories are important in every race that you compete in, Dale Earnhardt must be thinking about his seventh NASCAR Winston Cup Championship, the one that will tie him with Richard Petty for most.
And he made a rare mistake last week at Michigan, in my opinion. He got tangled up with Todd Bodine. He was on the outside, Bodine was on the inside, and they tangled and put Earnhardt out of the race. In fact, he put both of them out of the race. And I personally felt that he should have been driving a little bit more conservatively at that time.
Folks, I'm telling you, Harry Gant is driving that car as hard as he possibly can, trying to get by Earnhardt.
Best performance of 94.
And you say, well, Earnhardt moved over and let Mark Martin go. Why does he let Harry Gant go? The tires. You see, Harry Gant has the Hoosier tires on. Earnhardt has the Goodyears on. That's one reason that he hasn't moved. And watch Harry Gant. He's on the flat of the racetrack.
Boy, cowboy. Harry's best finish of the year was a seventh at Charlotte. So he is having his best performance in his final year of competition.
He's fourth right now in this race.
Watch this, folks. Worth watching again. Watch this.
The black part is the apron of the racetrack. Watch as he almost runs in the back of Earnhardt and goes down and gets all four tires on the apron. Man, is he trying.
And he's 54 years old, but still has the fire of a 24-year-old. 20 laps to go now. We will come back from this commercial break and show you the conclusion of the Goodies 500. Will it be Wallace, Martin, Earnhardt, Gant, or Waltrip? Stay with us. And some great shots from high above Bristol Raceway, courtesy of Steel, makers of a full line of outdoor power equipment. Powerful, easy to use, durable. Qualities you can depend on in Steel territory. And speaking of durable, it is time once again, that time of year for college football. Join us Thursday, September the 1st, that's this coming Thursday, at 8 o'clock Eastern Time for CFA action, Arizona against Georgia Tech from Atlanta. Harry Gant is off the pace.
Looks like he has a flat tire. You know, he got that on the apron of the racetrack, and that just might have caused the tire to go flat.
Here's what happened. He was racing with Dale Earnhardt when the problem occurred.
He almost runs in the back of Earnhardt. He has to hit the brakes. He goes out on the apron of the racetrack. John Kernan, what's the problem?
Benny, they don't really know. I just talked to Leo Jackson. At first, they got up ready to change tires. They thought he had a right rear tire going down. But right now, they're not sure that's the problem. They don't know what the problem is. The car just will not drive the way it did earlier on in the race.
And here, we can see that he's fighting the car just to get around the racetrack.
But he's only got 9 laps to go, so undoubtedly he's going to finish. But it will not be his best performance of 1994. He is down now to 9th spot. The lead continues to be held by Rusty Wallace. There you see the interval that he has over Mark Martin. Still battling out there on the racetrack, Sterling Marlin and Michael Waltrip. This is for 6th.
And Todd Bodine. Right behind them is Todd Bodine, who's been in the shot all day. So there he is.
Yep, that threesome have been going at it.
6th, 7th, and 8th. Rusty Wallace has won 5 times this year. Can he make it 6? Mark Martin is closing in with 6 laps to go.
And they're coming up on some pretty heavy traffic. Rusty will catch him in about 2 laps. And every time they get in traffic, he's careful there, of course, but Mark Martin is picking up on him.
The interval differential between Wallace and Martin, about 4/10 of a second.
And now they're going to put a lap on Harry Gant.
Now this is the break that Martin I need, because he's got the two cars in front of Rusty in side by side, Jeremy Mayfield and Harry Gant.
Boy, Rusty wants Mayfield to get down to the inside of the racetrack out of the way, and Martin did catch it.
Mark Martin is now within striking distance with less than four laps to go. He passes Jeremy Mayfield in the second corner. The interval about two car lengths as they head into three again.
And we've got Derek Cope coming up on him. Rusty don't want to have to pass on the outside. He wants to pass on the inside, because Martin really runs up on him when he has to pass on the outside.
498 about to be complete. Comes up and passes Derek Cope, and so does Mark Martin. Next time around, the white flag.
Dennis Rader is in front of him. Don't know if they'll catch him before they get back, before the race ends or not. It's going to be a race to the end. Here's the white flag.
One more to go. Let's see how Wallace and Martin end this thing. Off of the second corner, and Rusty Wallace goes to the inside of Ken Schrader.
That's
so does Martin. But Rusty Wallace is going to win it. Here's the checkered flag. Wallace wins his sixth victory of 94. Let's see how this battle comes out. Marlin, Michael Waltrip, Todd Bodine, they finish in that order, 6th, 7th, and 8th. There's the Miller Genuine Draft Crew as they celebrate Rusty's fifth win at Bristol. John Kernan is with Buddy Parrott.
Well, Buddy Parrott's getting congratulated by everyone down here on pit road. The celebration has just about stopped. Buddy is talking to doing a radio interview right now. But Buddy, congratulations. You guys did a great job tonight.
Thanks a lot. You know, the whole crew deserved it. We had some great pit stops. David Evans, I'll tell you what, that was one heck of a motor tonight. All the guys in the engine shop and Miller Genuine Draft, I'll tell you what, the sponsorship, everything was great. And just glad to win this race. I just signed a two-year contract, and it's a great way to start it off.
Yes, indeed it is. And he'll be heading to Victory Lane, where the celebration is probably only just beginning.
Rusty Wallace wins his eighth victory in the last 16 short track races. And he has made his way into Victory Lane.
He broke in that new uniform in the right kind of way, didn't he?
He sure did.
Ching, ching. Ching, ching.
This is his 37th career win.
Sixth man, but I got to win.
You got it.
The next great hand.
To his growing list of victories here in 1994. He's won at Rockingham, Martinsville, Dover, Pocono, Michigan, and now at Bristol.
I
wonder how tired he is, because I tell you what, this is a tough, tough race. 500 laps through Bristol wears you completely out.
And I'll bet he'll say, I'm glad there were not many more laps to go.
Here's Jerry Punch.
And you would think he'd be exhausted, but he's talking and smiling. And let's listen as he climbs out of the car. Here's Rusty Wallace.
Here you go, doctor.
And Rusty, what a way to break in the new uniform, the new colors. Oh, congratulations.
Yeah, RP picked these colors out. Mr. Penske said, hey, this is going to bring you a victory. It looked like it worked okay.
Your car awfully strong tonight. Bodine looked like he had the car to beat.
Yeah, Jeff was real strong, but right there at the end, you know, I got right up on his rear end. The Goodyear tires really started coming in right there at the end. Those Hoosiers are pretty sticky for a good short run, but everything went good today. Just like to thank all the sponsors, Miller, Goodyear, and Mobil, and Bosch, and all of them. But above all, my entire crew, because, boy, we really did a bad job last week on pit stops. We practiced this week, and they did a great job. I'm glad that Mr. Penske's here to watch this again, and I just hope that Ernie Irvin's watching, and we're wishing you well, buddy. I'll be up there Monday to see you.
Did you know that Jeff Bodine had a problem with the motor? You were like a foot off his rear bumper, and they said it's out of water and it could blow at any moment. Were you aware of that?
Yeah, I sure was. I radioed to the crew. I said, he's getting a lot of smoke. You know, I said, I think it's ready to blow any time. And so We just had a drive hard. Boy, Mark Martin had a great car. I could take my hat off to their crew. They did a wonderful job. And, boy, that traffic right there at the very end made a real race out of it. But if you can win them that way, it's all the more exciting.
You said earlier in the week that the spotter here at this racetrack was the key person, and Roger Penske was your spotter tonight.
Well, no, Don Miller was my spotter. Roger Penske was my coach, my driving coach, and that's what he does. He's really good about, he said, you're getting in a corner too deep, get out of throttle, float it in, you know, let that front end take a set, and he was doing things like that. And Don Miller, my spotter, just did a killer job all night long spot, and I really love the way Don did his job tonight.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Rusty Wallace in victory lane for the sixth time in 1994. Bob?
And it's the 19th Ford win in 22 races. Rusty Wallace beats Mark Martin, Dale Earnhardt, Darrell Waltrip, and Bill Elliott. Those are the top five. Back with more from Bristol after this. Well, the race is over. Rusty Wallace has won, and thousands of race fans have watched it here and millions here in the United States and around the world on Sky Sport. Once again, carrying our NASCAR Winston Cup race. They're going to be leaving us in a few minutes, and we hope you enjoyed our coverage here this evening. Darrell Waltrip has an outstanding race. Here's John Kernan.
I tell you, Bob, you should have seen the smile on ODW's face when he got out of that Western Auto car. Darrell, great run for you guys tonight.
It really was. The motor was fantastic. The car was really good. It got the weather so different than what we have here normally in August. I anticipated a slicker racetrack and had the car too tight. Nothing I could do about it. That's kind of was my call. But if I could have known the weather was going to be this cool and what the track's going to be like, I'd have run right up there and won this thing. But I'm tickled. I praise the Lord for a great race, and praise the Lord for Ernie getting well. He's going to be back with us here before long. Had a great night. John Leach, everybody at Western Auto, love you, buddy.
All right, thank you, Darrell. Congratulations on fine fourth place finish.
Did I forget anything?
I think you got everything in there, DW.
And Ernie, I told you I was back.
Bob.
It's his fourth straight top 10 finish. Darrell Waltrip is on a roll this year. Well, let's see how things are going to shake out in terms of points. Dale Earnhardt is going to retain the lead. Mark Martin moves to second. Rusty to third. Ernie Irvin has dropped to fourth place. Ken Schrader stays in fifth. But look, there's only 2 points separation between Wallace and Martin, and Benny helped me out on this. 199 separate first from second.
201.
201. Oh, I was close. Now the second five, Rudd, Shepard, Waltrip, Jeff Gordon, and Bill Elliott. Michael moved up one, Gordon up down one, and Elliott up one. The 11th through 15th in the point standings, Lake Speed, Darrell Waltrip, Terry Labonte, Sterling Marlin, and Kyle Petty. We'll be back with a lot more from here in Bristol as Rusty Wallace has won the Goodies 500. Stay with us. Crowd begins to file out of Bristol Raceway after seeing 500 laps of great racing here tonight that was won by Rusty Wallace, Mark Martin second, Dale Earnhardt third, Darrell Waltrip finished in fourth position, and Bill Elliott fifth. Another win for Ford. In fact, three of the top five are Fords.
6 through 10, Sterling Marlin, Michael Waltrip, Todd Bodine. Remember that big race we saw all night long? Harry Gent finished ninth after a great run, and Rick Mastin 10th.
And 11 through 15th, Ted Musgrave, Ricky Rudd, Kenny Wallace, Brett Bodine, and Kyle Petty.
And Ernie Irvin, Kenny Wallace finished 13th and didn't tear your car up.
That's right, and he only was one lap down at the finish. There are the 16 through 20th finishers, 21st through 25th. They include Jeff Bodine, who started from the front row. Dale Jarrett had a good race until falling back to 26th, being involved in the crash in turn four. Jeff Gordon also involved in an incident early on in the race. Ward Burton finishes in 36th. Position. Jerry Punch is with Harry Gann.
He may not show up in the top five, but if there's an effort award tonight, it has to go to you, Harry. Congratulations. Everyone wants to congratulate you. What a show you put on.
Well, we tried as hard as I could try tonight. You know, we just give up a lot of spots on the pit stops, but then at last we just got some tires there. Something was wrong with the rear tire. I couldn't run the car. You know, all night we got good tires. I really didn't see any difference between the Goodyears and the Hoosiers. They were the first that I had, I ran too long on them, but after that, everything equalized, and they all ran the same amount of laps, and they were really equal tonight.
some speculation upstairs that maybe when you tried to dive beneath Earnhardt, that on the apron of the track, a pretty brave move there, that something may have broken in the back of the car. Anything snap?
No, the tire just, you know, was a little too much air in it. Earnhardt, if I got by him, it might have been a little bit better. You know, I used up a lot of rubber there trying to get by him, but he was holding, trying to hold his position, too.
Tell you what, the guy doesn't look 54, and he just rode 500 laps of the toughest track in the country.
And didn't win.
But a ninth place finish for Harry Gant and a very, very good race. Back with more from Bristol in a moment. Wins the Goodies 500 here at Bristol. Mark Martin finishes in second position. Now, in the closing laps, this is what happened when Mark came upon Mike Wallace.
Now, Rusty had just passed him a lap before that, and Mike sort of took the groove there for a little bit, giving his brother a little bit of a cushion, let him pull away. Mark was only about three car lengths behind Rusty when they came up on Mike, and of course, he lost a little bit of distance there.
John Kernan is with Mark Martin.
Well, Mark, we just saw the final few laps. Looks like maybe one of the Wallace brothers might have held you up there at the end.
No, not really. Rusty had us beat there. Their pit stops were awesome, and they had a fast race car, and I didn't have enough time to work him over.
You need to get a brother out here to help you out maybe, huh?
Well, you know, a lot of the guys, most of the guys who would see the leaders coming with 10 to go would just pull over and stop till they got by. I know just about all of them would do that, especially if they weren't racing for position, but Mike's new at this thing, and he's trying real hard to make it, and when you're under that kind of pressure, sometimes you do things differently than you do when you got some security.
Yeah, a tough racetrack tonight. We go to another tough racetrack next week. A great finish here. The momentum, can you build it into next week?
Well, we sure hope so. We think we ran good enough to be in contention to win this thing, and just one spot off last week. We love going to Darlington. The Valvoline team had a great run here tonight. I couldn't be happier with it. I would sure like to have won. We sure got close there at the end, but, you know, it was going to take a miracle to get by Rusty in one or two laps. So I didn't really catch him till two to go. So we'll go to Darlington with some brand-new cars, Busch Grand National and Winston Cup, and they really look good, and I'm excited about going.
One last thing. Ernie had the television in his room tonight. Any messages you want to send to him?
Hey, Ernie, I'll see you tomorrow. I'll be up there tomorrow and tell you all about that Busch Grand National car you got there. What we need to do to get that thing going.
All right, thank you very much, Mark. Bob?
Thanks. Mark Martin, in his last three races, his finishes have been first, second, and second. And there are the sentiments of all of us. We'll be right back. Wallace.
Well, Kenny, 13th place, a respectable finish considering everything.
Well, you know, that's not a Robert Yates finish, but, considering the circumstances, we fitted the seat up on a Wednesday, and we run about 11th all night long, and at the end there I got a little bit tight. But, now I can concentrate on the seat, the steering wheel a little bit more, and things just weren't exactly right. And, I think that we kept Robert second in the Connors points. And, like I say, we're not content, but we'll go on to Darlington, and I know we're going to be better from here on out.
Hey, but it hasn't been a bad week for this guy. He won last night. He's got one of the best rides in the business for a short while until Ernie Irvin comes back, and he can manage a smile here after 500 laps. Bob?
And we will see him and the other NASCAR Winston Cup competitors when we go to Darlington for the Mountain Dew Southern 500 next Sunday afternoon. We'll be back in a moment. Wins the Goodies 500. Mark Martin finishes in second. Dale Earnhardt third, and fourth and fifth were Darrell Waltrip and Bill Elliott.
Ned, I think Dale Earnhardt's off and running.
Yep, he's in good shape. He got by with this one here tonight.
Yes, sir.
And there you see the completion of the top 10. We run down the rest of the finishers in tonight's race. Kenny Wallace for Ernie Irvin finishes in 13th position.
Jeremy Mayfield, Jeff Bodine, all that problems he had, blew up, finished 23rd.
In fact, all of these cars that we're seeing here now had problems of one sort or another, either wreck or some kind of problems.
We'll see if John Andretti is back with Richard Petty toward the first of the week. We don't know whether he's going to be the driver at the Southern 500 next week or not, but we will let you know when we go there next weekend.
Bob, they're going to get together Monday. They're going to sit down in Richard's office and talk it over and say,
Okay, we want to continue with you. John, do you want to continue with us or however it may go?
Another one of those traditional events that we're very, very honored to bring you will be next Sunday afternoon at 1 o'clock Eastern Time from the famed Darlington Speedway in South Carolina, the Mountain Dew Southern 500. Started in 1950, the 94 edition, next Sunday afternoon, live here on ESPN at 1 o'clock Eastern Time. Well, the 70 or so thousand people are still trying to make their way toward the exits after seeing an interesting and exciting evening of racing here at the Bristol High Banks. Rusty Wallace is the winner. And now we look forward to next Sunday. That's always fun, Benny.
I tell you what, I look forward to the Southern 500, and even more so now that I'm not driving, because I'm in an air-conditioned booth, not in a hot race car.
Miller Genuine Draft Crew proud of the performance that they turned in tonight and that their driver turned in tonight. Again, Rusty Wallace wins here at Bristol. For Ned Jarrett, Benny Parsons, John Kernan, and Dr. Jerry Punch, this is Bob Jenkins. We'll see you next weekend.